It's an important week in NASCAR history as the stock car circuit takes its first ever points-paying race outside the United States. They come to Mexico, to a land rich in history, culture, tradition, and diversity, to a track that was built for Formula One and made famous and named for the Rodriguez brothers, Ricardo, a brilliant young star, and Pedro, who scored two Grand Prix victories. They've been filing in since early this morning, 110,000 strong, into this beautiful racing facility. Where yesterday, welcome to the NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by America Online. Where yesterday, history was made, as for the seventh time in NASCAR Busch Series history, a first-timer took the pole. Jorge Gutters to the admiring throng, scoring the pole position, and now we are set to go racing for points for the first time outside the United States.
Procedemos con la parte, decíamos, más formal de este evento. Quiero presentar a ustedes al padre Luis Guillermo Anaya Reyes, párroco de la iglesia de San Jacinto, quien va a dar la bendición para esta carrera. Adelante, padre.
En el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo, te pedimos, Señor, que bendigas a cada uno de estos corredores, a sus escuderías, a sus autos, para que llegado el mejor a la meta final nos llene a todos de alegría. God bless to the drivers of NASCAR Busch, and the blessing of God Omnipotent, Father and Son, and the Holy Spirit go with you. Good luck to all.
Gracias al padre Luis Guillermo Anaya Reyes. Vamos ahora, como parte de esta ceremonia cívica, este importante acto, solicitamos, con todo respeto y como siempre lo hemos hecho en México, solicito de la manera más atenta, nos pongamos de pie. Queremos agradecer al ingeniero José Manuel Alavés González, director corporativo de Desarrollo CIE, pase a ocupar su lugar frente a la escolta de bandera para que con los honores de ordenanza desenfunde nuestro emblema nacional. En dicho acto lo acompaña la banda de guerra de la Policía Bancaria e Industrial del Distrito Federal. Adelante, ingeniero José Manuel Alavés. Bien, vamos ahora a continuar con la presentación de quien tiene el honor de interpretar el himno nacional mexicano. Vamos a cantarlo con ella, gran cantante mexicana, conocida y reconocida. Ana Bárbara, con ustedes.
Gracias, gracias. Mexicanos al grito de guerra, el acero a prestar y el bridón. Y retiembla en sus centros la tierra al sonoro rugir del cañón. Y retiembla en sus centros la tierra al sonoro rugir del cañón. Ciño patria, tú sienes de oliva, de la paz del arcángel divino, que en el cielo tu eterno destino por el dedo de Dios se escribió. Mas si osare un extraño enemigo profanar con su planta tu suelo. Pienso, patria querida, que el cielo un soldado en cada hijo te dio, un soldado en cada hijo te dio. Todos mexicanos al grito de guerra, el acero a prestar y el grito, y retiemble en sus centros la tierra al sonoro rugir del cañón. Y retiemble en sus centros la tierra al sonoro rugir del cañón.
El aplauso, y con todo respeto, vamos a escuchar el himno nacional de los Estados Unidos. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we listen the USA national anthem with Zach, Taylor and Isaac by Hanson.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? Oh, the land of the free and the home of the
Ok, el aplauso para Hanson, agradeciendo a...
Over 110,000 people, weekend attendance, over 150,000, getting set to watch the NASCAR Busch Series cars go 80 laps around this unique course with its twists and turns, and we have a few of our own.
Let's go racing, boys, in Spanish. In Spanish, let's a correr, muchachos. Ándale, arriba, arriba. NASCAR on Fox. Yeah. Welcome, everybody, from Fox to Mexico City.
Excitement in the air and a packed house at the Autodromo Hernandos Rodriguez as NASCAR on Fox presents the NASCAR Busch Series, presented today by America Online. Yesterday, 34-year-old Jorge Getters won the pole for this race and the support race. Robbie Gordon, whom he knocked off the pole, showed his approval to the crowd, as this Mexican driver, whom most of the Busch Series regulars had never heard of, scored the pole on what he called the greatest day of his life. Jeff Hammond.
Well, right now, we're out here beside Jorge Getter's car, and we're getting ready to hook him up. And, Jorge, you're getting ready to bring these guys down for a historic start, and you look around, and you got all these superstars basically chasing after you. What are you thinking right now?
Yeah, I'm ready, and I'm very glad to be here at the first place, and let's race and have fun.
He's ready to have fun, guys.
He's a veteran of this course. He led much of yesterday's support race, the Corona Challenge, which was won by his brother. He'll be a formidable force at the front of the field, as will the hometown hero, Adrian Fernandez, who will start at the rear in a provisional. And in between all the Busch Series regulars and bushwhackers from the Nextel Cup Series, this is going to be exciting for 80 laps. Let's go trackside.
Eugenio Derbez, nuestro gran marshal.
Buenas tardes, México! ¡Viva México! ¡Viva! Señores, esta carrera va a estar de peluches. Así es que esperemos que no nos llueva, porque si no se van a mojar horrible, horrible. Drivers, start your engines.
About one octave up on boogity boogity boogity, folks.
You gotta love that.
Let's go trackside and Matt Yoakum.
Mike, this 2.5 mile serpentine course, the 45th different track in NASCAR Busch Series history. Today, when they drop the green flag, 9 Mexicans will roll underneath, making history. No name is bigger in this country than that of Adrian Fernandez. To put it in perspective, this open wheel star's popularity in the United States, imagine no NFL, no Major League Baseball, no NBA. And then think of Dale Earnhardt Jr. not only as the biggest star in auto racing, but the biggest star in the entertainment world. Now, Fernandez, driving his Hendrick Chevrolet, crashed in qualifying. He will now start the 5 car in the 40th position. He'll have to turn in a legendary performance if he wants to take the checkered flag and go to victory lane this afternoon. To Jeff Hammond.
And Matt, you mentioned all the countrymen as far as Mexico's concerned, but as of yesterday, Jorge Getter became the number one Mexican as far as they're concerned today at this racetrack. He's going to be leading this elite field down to the start of this race, and he is really pumped up. His whole family's pumped up. The emotion is so high that yesterday when he sat on the pole, his father had tears running down his face because he was so excited for his son, and he's ready to carry on exactly the way he wants to do it. One more time, he's going to lead these guys to the green, Matt.
Jeff, as NASCAR writes a new page in historic history, another old tradition, though, resurfaces here on this road course. You've got guys like Forrest Senn, a Daytona champion. You've got guys like Ron Fellows, who's not only won at Le Mans, but at Daytona. He has 3 Busch Series wins, 2 NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series wins, all on road courses. You throw in other guys like Rusty Wallace, who's penciled in this race, and guys like Kevin Harvick near the front, all NASCAR drivers who've gone to victory lane in some form on a road course in NASCAR history. These guys are all here because they want to win this inaugural race here in Mexico. Jeff?
That's right, Mike, Matt. Everybody wants to win, but more importantly, when you think about the regulars, and we're talking about guys like Reed Sorensen, Carl Edwards, as well as Clint Bowyer, these guys right now, they're trying to get their points. Points are so important. They realize winning is very important down here. It's going to be very impressive, but at the end of the year, the guy who can capture the Busch Championship will have to come out of Mexico with a good finish.
Thanks, Jeff. Let's take a look at the big picture before we concentrate fully on today's race. There are the NASCAR Busch Series standings. In positions 2, 3, and 4 are the leading men who will race all the events for the championship, along with Aston Lewis Jr., defending champ Martin Truex Jr., Paul Menard, and David Green. For all of these drivers, this course is new, this 2.5 mile, 8-turn road race course, and it wasn't friendly to everyone, particularly Carl Edwards. Edwards goes off course here without much harm, but trying to avoid Kim Crosby at the chicane kills a car. He was okay. They unloaded the backup car, kaboom. It's been a rough weekend for Carl Edwards and crew.
to me, that was probably one of my better laps, which I usually don't do that in qualifying. I usually do something really stupid, and it went really well there today. So I'm happy with it. Hopefully it holds up for a good starting spot. But, man, we've got some great drivers getting ready to go.
Carl Edwards redeemed himself with a great qualifying position. Hi, everybody. Mike Joy, Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds. The anticipation is kind of like no race we've done all year, maybe no race we've done in most of the 4 years of NASCAR on Fox. But, Darrell, when they wave the green flag, what do we expect?
Well, first of all, I love this joint. I mean, I've been to the Super Bowl and the Daytona 500. Excitement in the air. But nothing like I've seen here for the last 2 days. These people are ecstatic. They're excited about us being here. They're looking forward to a great race. I'm anticipating that start you're talking about. They got to get through that chicane just past the start-finish line. You're going to have to be pretty much single file to make it through there. You saw what happened to Carl Edwards. We don't want that to happen to anybody on the start of the race.
And then right after the chicane, turn one.
Oh, it's even worse. Got that sippy hole that's right off the end of the course down there. They'll probably find some people stuck in it before they get too far along.
And Larry, it's been a long week for these teams as we see the run from the chicane down to the 90-degree right-hand turn number one. Wow, the first lap's going to be something. But just to get here and to get to this stage where we have cars on course ready to race, it's really been a hard work week on these teams.
Well, it has. I mean, they were in Fontana, California last week. They're here this week, and then they'll be in Las Vegas, Nevada. But just to support a little bit of what Darrell says, as we saw at the video with Carl Edwards, things are always lurking at a road course. As you saw, you can always get off the racetrack. These guys, for 80 laps, they'll be shifting 7, 8, 9 times a lap. Mechanical problems are always lurking. We have 25 drivers making their first road course start in one of the top three series. Including our pole sitter, we have 7 drivers making their first Busch Series start. They have things they've never encountered, getting on and off pit road under green, pit road speed. And if that's not enough, these teams, since we run backwards here from an oval, the pit stops are backwards. But I guarantee you, to support what Jeff Hammond and Matt Yoakum talk about, talking to these drivers and these race teams, everyone would love to claim that they won the race in the first Busch Series race outside of the United States. They really would love that title.
For NASCAR, it is a day of firsts. It's also a day of great unknowns. And this 8-turn road course is really going to be an action track. And you'll see it unfold right here on NASCAR on Fox. Under cloudy skies in Mexico City, the NASCAR Busch Series cars on the first of their pace laps. The field split in two by the pace vehicles to gauge pit road speed. The weather's changed since this morning.
A lot cooler, a lot cloudier, 72 degrees, mostly cloudy. This racetrack will have a lot more grip. It's not going to be quite as slick as it was yesterday in qualifying and Friday during practice.
Let's see if we can get old Carl Edwards. He has had an exciting weekend here. Carl Edwards, this is a DW up in the Fox TV booth. Bud, you got a copy?
Loud and clear, DW.
I was going to tell you this with Jack Roush on the phone, but I thought it might scare you to death. So how you feeling, buddy? You going to be good today?
Yeah, I feel really good. I mean, the charter guys brought out a backup car that's fast. So, man, I'm loving this stuff. This is a fun racetrack. I feel good about it.
Any leftover residual effects from your little adventure there on Friday?
Yeah, a little bit of a sore neck. Hopefully we won't run into anything again today. That would really hurt.
All right, Carl. Have a good day, man, and we'll be watching.
Step forward. Thanks, guys. Carl, who's beside you now? Carl?
Let's show you what this racetrack looks like. As you see our track back, start-finish line will be right at the top center of your screen. Just exiting the oval, you see the chicane along the top, and in the upper right corner of your screen, Darrell, that's what could be Calamity Corner.
Yeah, right here is that chicane we're talking about, and it's single file through there. But once you make it through there, now you've got turn one, and it's a very high speed turn that you've got to almost come down to almost first gear there. You come out of there, got a little S, then you got this straightaway here called the back straightaway. Pretty nice place to pass, but here's where it gets difficult. Up through these S's, from there to there. It's all rhythm, switchbacks, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times you jerk on the wheel. Then you get out of there, now you got another straightaway, good passing place, but this is a tough turn. 7 and 8 coming onto the front straightaway. Really a hard turn.
There you see the length of the race, 80 laps, 201 miles. We talked about pit road speed, 35 miles per hour, but trust me, that pit window, 27 to 32 laps, that will be a factor in this race, because what these crew chiefs will do, they will run the race backwards. Let's say you can run 30 laps on fuel. They want to be on pit road by lap 50 to get full of fuel to keep that track position to the end.
Yeah, I think the key, Larry, is going to be just you got to stay up front. This is a hard place to pass. I think if you can stay up front all day, you got a shot at winning this thing.
Let's have a look at our Mr. Clean Auto Dry Car Wash starting lineup for NASCAR's first point race in Mexico. 34-year-old Jorge Gutters from Mexico City. He's the pole sitter in his first start. Knocked Robbie Gordon off the pole. Martin Truex Jr. and Forrest Sett, a road course ringer in row number two. Ron Fellows, the Canadian, with Kevin Harvick in row three. Paul Menard, who has only one road course start. Great seventh place effort. And Mexico's Carlos Contreras. There's Carl Edwards, who will start ninth alongside Elliott Sadler. David Green, the pole sitter's teammate and former series champ, with Tyler Walker, the fastest Dodge in the field. Clint Bowyer and Jamie McMurray, Bowyer's first time on a road course. He qualified 13th. Jason Keller and road race instructor Chris Cook in the eighth row. Tim Fedewa with Mexico City's Michelle Jourdain in row nine. Reed Sorensen, second in points, Ashton Lewis Jr. Ron Hornaday driving for Kevin Harvick in row 11 with Brent Sherman out of the Grand Am Series. J.J. Yaley, USAC Triple Crown champ with Stacy Compton in row 12. Scott Gaylord in the 52 has been replaced by Mexico City's Jimmy Morales. Brent Sherman with him there, Shane Meal. John Wood, Stanton Barrett, Johnny Sauter, Ryan Hemphill in the four. Rusty Wallace had a smooth lap, but only good for 31st. Next to Randy LaJoy, Jose Luis Ramirez from the NASCAR West Series, and Denny Hamlin from out of NASCAR Late Models, Kenny Wallace and David Stremme in a backup car, Ruben Garcia Novoa from Mexico, and Justin Labonte, whose dad Terry will be spotting down at the chicane, Mara Reyes, one of two women drivers in the field with Adrian Fernandez, the Mexican star who took a provisional, Shauna Robinson, Rafael Martinez, and Eric Jones. In this field, amongst the NASCAR Busch Series regulars and Cup drivers, Getters the pole sitter, Carlos Contreras, used to race in the Truck Series, Michelle Jourdain from Champ Car, Ramirez from NASCAR West, Novoa, Mara Reyes, who races in the Corona Challenge Series here, Adrian Fernandez, the open wheel star, Rafael Martinez. Let's get some last minute stories from pit road. Here's Matt.
Mike, as the field shuffles by behind me, they've been given the one lap to go. Now, 3 weeks ago at Daytona, right here on Fox, we talked a lot about deal making. Now, polling a number of drivers in the garage area this morning, there were a number of deals being made, but not what you might think. A lot of drivers were concerned about the start going into the chicane and turn one. So some drivers have worked out some deals where they'll be generous. Let one guy in, if he may have that position, they want to get through that area on the start very clean, because that can ruin your whole day if you have a bad start there. So even guys like Boris said and Ron Fellows, Jeff, doing a lot of talking with other drivers about being generous on this opening lap.
I know worrying about the start is one of the key things here today, but as the race progresses, one of the key places for the days, whoever's going to wind up winning this race is going to be on pit road. We've talked about it several times. They're going to have to make pit stops, when you make them, how critical they are. But today, one of the interesting notes is they're doing it backwards. This is not normal for a lot of these Busch teams. They're actually pitting the car backwards. And for a guy like Jorge Gutters, this is his first time in competitions to pit in this type of a scenario. So he told me he's a little bit concerned about that. Even his crew chief said he needs to get in as smooth as possible, get back off of pit road if we expect to have a chance of winning today. So on pit road is going to be real critical all day long.
And Larry, we've got some cars going to the back, and I wonder if we may have some drivers electing to go to the back.
Pick me. Talking about as far as that chicane in turn one, very well. I think the most significant is Robbie Gordon, who was on the outside pole, had an engine change
after Friday's practice. He will go to the rear. Chris Cook in the 7 car had an engine change to the rear as well. Tim Fedewa had transmission problems qualifying. We already talked about Jimmy Morales going to the rear because he's replacing Scott Gaylord. Adrian Fernandez in a backup car. But the thing we need to explain, and it's a little confusing, since Carl Edwards in the 60 car went to a backup car before qualifying and presented his car for qualifying with his race engine, he did not have to go to the rear of the field.
We're told J.J. Yaley may be going to the back as well. Says he may have a transmission problem or maybe electing.
Well, right where he's starting, Mike, is right where I think the trouble will be, right in the middle of the pack. It's going to bottleneck up when you get to that chicane, and it's going to be a chain reaction. I don't want to be in the middle, get run into somebody in the front, and get run over from the back.
Also, Ruben Novoa has elected to start at the rear. Let's talk about what is now the front row. Now that Robbie Gordon has moved to the rear, you have Jorge Guedes, who has raced in the Desafio Corona here. He's been a champion of the Mustang Cup, the Mexico Truck Series, and he's raced in Indy Lights. Most importantly, Darrell, he knows this racetrack. And alongside now, moving up from the second row with Robbie Gordon gone, you're going to have Boris Said, who is one of the world's premier pin-top or GT-type road racers.
I think it's more important to know the track than it is to be familiar with the car. Look what happened to
Fernandez.
Fernandez, yeah. He wrecked 2 cars. He knows the track, but he doesn't know the cars. So I think that's the deal.
Second row outside, you saw Kevin Harvick, new look for his car in white, red, and green. You'll see a lot of paint jobs you've never seen before today.
Look how long they're in. That's 7 and 8. And I mean, they're in that turn a long, long time.
This turn is called the Peraltada. It was built with 32 degrees of banking for Formula One, and then the banking was lowered. Now it's nearly flat and runs around the Ball Stadium. Back to the front straightaway.
Fellas, we are south of the border. Approach Los Cinturones. Tighten those belts, baby. Get her done.
Underlay, underlay. Arriba, arriba. Let's go racing.
Getter's got a good jump on Boris Said. Through the loop or chicane.
Mark Truex Jr. there in the 8 car. He's won challenge for the lead going off into turn 1. He'd like to get those 5 points for leading the first lap in a Busch race outside the United States.
I think he kind of overcooked the first turn there.
That's very easy to do. We've seen that
really
a lot.
Easy to do.
A very good clean start.
That dust you see, that's just from safety vehicles and all been around the track this morning. No problems.
Up to turn 4 and the NASCAR cut, which eliminated the Hector Rabaque turn, so that you see off to the right of your screen. This is turn 4.
In a really unorthodox turn. It's got about 3 hitches in it.
See Robbie Gordon right there in the 83 car. He's already made up about 10 or 12 positions. Remember, went to the rear of the field after that engine change.
Through turn 5. A left-hander.
The 4 car got shut down line there.
Ryan Hemphill.
And here are the S's. Here's the area, Darrell, where it's really easy to get behind.
It's just all rhythm, Mike. I mean, it's just, you know, you just saw it on the wheel. And it almost is like, can I just stop and start all over again?
And the oval straight. 2 off for Guedes, who becomes the first ever Hispanic driver to lead a NASCAR Busch Series race.
And as I said, the first Busch Series driver to lead a race outside of the United States.
Just, I tell you, don't count Guedes out all day long. That's a great team. Bruco, Newt Morris, crew chief. That guy can win this race.
Robbie Gordon comes across in 28th. He started this race back about 41st. Oh, a little shortcut by Jamie McMurray. That's from turn 1 to turn 3.
It's so easy. When you're coming down through that turn, Mike, there's no reference. You're running straight off into nothing. Does that make sense?
Yes,
straight
it does. Nothing is the pavement where you end up.
And David Hoots told the drivers at the drivers' meeting early this morning, if you cut part of the racetrack off and you gain positions, all you have to do is get those positions back and there will be no penalty.
What I mean is there's no visual reference down there for getting slowed down.
Mark Truex Jr. in 8 car starting to put a little bit of pressure on Jorge Guedes.
the 66. This 66 team now, this is the team that Greg Biffle has driven for the last two races and will be in the car next week at Las Vegas.
You know, Truex, when he raced in the Busch North Series, ran road races at Watkins Glen, New York, and Lime Rock, Connecticut. So he may have more road race experience than much of this field. Here comes Robbie Gordon. That's 83, new number for Robbie in the Busch Series this year, working under John Wood and under the 43 of Jose Luis Ramirez.
He'll get some of those back markers pretty quickly, but once you get on up into the top 20, it gets a little tougher.
He is now 25th. Well, make that 24th.
So he's made it through almost half the field in two laps, but the further you go, the harder it'll get.
Now, Adrian Fernandez is back in 33rd. He has not gained nearly as many positions as Gordon. At the front, Martin Truex Jr. trying to track down Jorge Getters of Mexico City.
And who is that lurking in third right there?
Well, that's the Nemechek car of Ron Fellows. Yeah. And here is a car that started scratch, Rafael Martinez in the zero. A lot of smoke from that car. And the 52 with Jimmy Morales, the local driver, replacing Scott Gaylord, who qualified that car. Also with trouble. Matt?
Mike, I had a long conversation with Martin Truex yesterday. He said the game plan today, race no one until the end. Keep the car on the racetrack. Just race his type of race. He's got a mirror full of Ron Fellows. Road course special is a legend, turning left and right, and also Jorge Getters up front. But he told me that he is feeling very confident about driving this race car to victory lane today. He said he feels like he has really stepped up his road racing prowess. In fact, his best career finish, a top five, a fifth at Watkins Glen in a Busch North car.
I like Fellows, though. Golly, yep. He's won in everything he's ever driven. Busch, truck, a couple of second-place finishes in Cup.
If Martin doesn't give him a little room, he may regret it.
Oh, yeah. Ron will outbreak him going down this back straightaway here, going into four. That's where road racers have got the advantage over guys that aren't necessarily that good of road racers.
But when you look at Jorge Getters in the 66 and Ron Fellows in the 87, they're here for one thing and one thing only, to win this race. But like you heard Jeff Hammond talk about, Martin Truex Jr., big picture. This is race number three of 35.
Jeff, how about Adrian Fernandez, who started in the back in a backup car and has moved up to 32nd?
Mike, what the deal is, I talked to Jim Long, the crew chief on this car. That's a brand new race car. It's never seen the racetrack until they dropped the green flag today. So he may be trying to seat the brakes a little bit, get some of the bugs kind of figured out in this race car. Be smart and realize this is a long race. We still have a long ways to go, no matter how far back we start. But being it's a new car, he just might be just thinking, let's just be real easy, make sure we keep all four tires on the track, and then be able to give some input back to Jim Long so they can work on that car and make it better by the end of the day.
Thanks, Jeff. This is the oval straight connecting the S's to turn 7 and 8. The Peraltada that lead onto the front straightaway.
Back Robbie Gordon. Here he comes. Whoa. You got Robbie.
Trying to move on Stacy Compton. He's past Kenny Wallace in the 22. As the leaders put four laps on the board. Jorge Getters from the pole has kept his Ford out front of Martin Truex Jr. Busch Series Racing on Fox is presented by America Online. Want a better internet? You belong in America Online. And brought to you by AC Delco. Real car guys know AC Delco. Aaron's. Aaron's makes dreams come true with dream prices on dream products. And Subway. Experience the great taste of a fresh toasted sub today. Subway, eat fresh. A lot of diversity in this front five as we've completed six laps. A Mexican driver leading, a driver from New Jersey, a Canadian in third as you ride with Ron Fellows, a Californian of Middle Eastern descent in fourth, Morris Sed, and a Mexican, Carlos Contreras, in fifth. Now, Robbie Gordon started 38th, climbed his way up to 24th. But then, his number 83 appeared to have problems. You'll see Gordon pull out of line on this straightaway.
Looks like gearbox when he does like that. I don't know. Maybe Jeff can tell us.
DW, what's going on right now with Robbie's car is they're speculating they have a problem either with a plug wire or a plug has quit working. He said all of a sudden the engine just seemed like it lost power. It's still running, but it's running flat. And again, they're hoping that it's something they can work on and repair. But as we've already seen earlier this week, they did have engine problems when they first got here, and their woes may be continuing.
And we talked about the shifting that goes on here, and they're not turning that many RPMs like we normally turn, about 9,000 RPM. But all it takes is miss a shift or something, and you can have your share of problems.
Boy, Ron Fellows is just wearing Truex out. I mean, he's putting every road race movie nose on him. Ron can't get off of a turn two there, three, to get him down turn four. That's where he'd like to pass him.
Right on this straightaway, right the back straight.
Yeah. Martin gets out there a little bit better than Ron does.
Fellows in the 87 from Mississauga, Ontario. Veteran road racer. Had a lot of success driving Corvettes. And John Wood, in the 47 from Stewart, Virginia. He said, on this road course, I feel like Jet Clampett in Beverly Hills. I am lost.
Saw Ramirez there, the 43 car. Looks like he has been smoking for several laps. I believe he's in trouble as well.
The 43, Ramirez, off then on.
Has a right front down. It's a long way around this road course, over 2.5 miles to get back to the pits.
And that's easy to do, Larry, with these curves. You hit that tire up on a curve, you can knock it off the wheel.
He apparently put some debris on the track because caution waves for the first time today. Now, under NASCAR rules, at the moment of caution, the field is frozen. There are 11 scoring loops located at various points around this racetrack, and a driver is scored as of the last loop that he passed. That was John Wood in Beverly Hills, I think, somewhere, not in the chicane, but elsewhere.
As he said, a little bit lost.
And like we mentioned earlier,
making real good time.
Any positions he gained, as long as he gives them back, there would be no penalty for that.
Ramirez at 4 feet 11. Not the tallest driver in the field, but, oh boy, now here's trouble.
Yeah, that's when the car comes apart. The tire comes apart and beats the car to death.
Yeah, they're not running that inner liner, that safety shield here like we do a lot of speedways, but those curves are flat in the tire.
Dr. Ramirez this morning, he was really excited about running this race in his home country. Tough luck. We're under caution in Mexico City. Pit road is open. Second place Martin Truex Jr. is in. Mexican star Adrian Fernandez is in, and more. Here's Matt.
Truex gives up the second spot. Now, the game plan originally, Mike, was to go with the leader, but Jorge Getter stayed out. Truex telling Bono Mannion, the car is loose on exit on the right-handers. The car could turn better. It was losing grip, and he's down and away. To Jeff Hammond.
Right now, Robbie Gordon's crew's gone to work under the hood, trying to determine whether it's a plug wire or what kind of engine problem they may be having right now. Robbie said, guys, work on the engine, put some gas in it, and see if we can diagnose what the problem is. Do not worry about tires right now.
Among the title contenders, David Green and Reed Sorensen were both in. I'd say about a dozen, 15 cars came in under this caution flag.
Yeah, you know, you can do a lot of work on a race car on a road course because it takes a long time for that pace car to come back around.
But I think the most surprising car that made a pit stop was probably Martin Truex Jr. He was about the only car in the top 12 or 14 that came to pit road.
I know why he pitted. He got tired of Ron wearing him out. He wanted to get him off his back bumper.
But just to make sure that we make everyone understand why a lot of these leaders did not pit, this is an 80-lap race. The crew chiefs tend to run this race backwards, like I was talking in the beginning. So what that means, if you can run 30 laps on fuel, if you get to pit road by lap 50, you can go to the end. If you can get to pit road by lap 18 to 20, that means you can do it on one stop. You want to make as few pit stops as possible. What I don't like about Mark Truex Jr.'s strategy, he will still have to make two pit stops.
Robbie Gordon has returned to his pit. Tough break for the outside.
All right, next. I've been lost in my own place.
green. Back to Mexico City for the first points-paying race in a NASCAR National Touring Series. Here at the Autodromo, Hernandos Rodriguez, the Telcel Motorola Mexico 200 is the title of today's race. This facility built for Formula One, but I think there's almost 100,000 seats here, and some folks improvise and find their own.
I think Hammond set those up over there. He's renting those ladders out this weekend.
But it's a big double-deck cantilever grandstand, seats and suites along both sides of the front straightaway, a modern control tower, and cars snaking their way around the circuit here in turn four in the Hector Rabaque section of the track leading toward turn number five. And let's get out of the pits and find out why Martin Truex Jr. was the only driver in the top 20 to make a pit stop. Matt?
Martin gave up the second spot as Kevin Bono Mannion called him in the pits. He will restart from the 20th position. Bono, my math says around lap 44, 45, you'd pit, and then you can make it to the end. Is that correct?
Well, we'll see what happens. We're going to check our gas mileage here. The possibly some rain in the area. We're just doing a little different strategy, and we'll see what happens.
He will restart from the 20th position. Now, Bono, Jeff, told Martin, just keep it on the track and save fuel. We should be good.
That's definitely the strategy about every one of these teams up down pit road. But right now, for Robbie Gordon, they're having a lot of trouble with his car. They came back in the pit, and they're trying to find out maybe if it's a spark plug problem. So when the team came down on pit road this time, they took a heat gun and checked the exhaust temperature in each one of the cylinders on the header pipe, then made a determination that they wanted to change the spark plug on the coldest exhaust temperature in the engine. They did that, they're back on the racetrack, and they're hoping that maybe that'll fix their problem.
I don't think it does, Jeff. I heard him leave pit road, and that thing sounded terrible. Sound about like I do.
Just to follow up on the Martin Truex story, remember this is an 80-lap race. He pitted on lap 9. That means he would have to run about 35 to 36 laps on each of these two runs to do it on one stop. It's a long way.
We'll complete 11 laps this time by as we go back to green. We've not yet had a lead change. Jorge Gutierrez, in his first NASCAR Busch Series start, has led them all, but now he has Ron Fellows, the Canadian, breathing down his neck, and Boris Said, one of America's best road racers. Fellows dives, nope. Opens the door for Said, nope.
Well, I think Ron Fellows in 87 somewhat summed it up. Watching that 66 car for the first 8 laps, he knew how good he was. He's going to try him on the outside of turn 1 here.
That's the same thing that Martin Truex tried on the opening lap on Gutierrez. Didn't work for him either. That 66 car with Gutierrez on board, it's getting the job done, boys.
That's a Bruco car, a team car to David Green. Set looking. And he's not alone. That number 40 is Carlos Contreras.
Whoa, looking on the outside
and
there.
He's going to get Menard. He got Menard. Menard's trying to get him back. Nope.
Something's going to give right there. Of course, Menard gave him a little room.
Right behind them, the 21, Kevin Harvick. And the 60 of Carl Edwards.
Considering what Carl Edwards and that race team has been through for the last 2 days, this is a great run for this group.
Carl better win the race.
Here's Matt.
Gutierrez out front at 66 car, having a very impressive run. But Mike, before we dropped the green flag today, he was talking to Newt Moore from the 66 team. Newt was reminding him about pit road speed for their pit stop today, but he also was talking to him about what gear he was actually going to start the race in, and also on the restarts. Gutierrez wasn't sure whether he should go with first or second. Newt said, it is up to you, whatever you feel the most comfortable. Right now, Gutierrez says the car is pushing on exit. Newt is encouraging him to pace himself. There's a lot of laps left in this race, so don't overdrive it too soon.
And one of the concerns, Larry, I know that the crew chiefs were telling us this morning, front tire wear. that these cars through these S's and then some of these tight turns really sliding the front tires and wearing them out.
And you know, that certainly could have been what happened to the 43 car a little while ago, Ramirez.
Jorge Gitters and Ron Fellows. So it's Mexico, Canada, and the United States. With Boris said in third, they did have an Olympics in Mexico City. I feel like we're having one right now.
I'm just impressed with Gitters. I mean, you know, he's not a rookie. Obviously, he ran second here last night in the preliminary event. But, man, he's just getting the job done. So smooth.
Of course, Darrell, when you're the leader, you don't have to worry about those fellas. You get to race the racetrack.
He's running the kind of race I'd like to race. Sit on the pole, lead every lap. That's a great race. Whoa.
Contreras looked inside of Boris Sen entering turn 7. And exiting 8, they may be side by side.
Well, Carlos is turning up the heat a little bit.
Darrell, it looks like Boris Sen in one car, he just can't get off the corner. He can't put that throttle down and stay in it. It's spinning the rear tire.
This track has a lot of grip. I was out on it this morning, and it has a lot of grip. But you got to remember, these guys got 750 horsepower they're trying to apply.
That's Kevin Harvick in white and green right there, number 21, and Carl Edwards behind him in the 10. Michelle Jourdain in the Telcel Ford. That's a BBC racing car. He's running the entire Busch Series, but he's also one of Mexico City's favorites in this race.
And we've been getting a little bit of report that on Michelle Jourdain, the 10 car, we're getting a little tire smoke. It looks like maybe he has a little bit of left front fender damage, but now he is already up to the 8th position after starting back in 18th. Has a ton of laps at this racetrack, but none in the heavier stock car.
Hey, you see that smoke trailing there? I don't know if that's tires or not. Looks pretty, quite a bit of smoke.
13 of 80 laps complete. They work through the S's and out of turn number 6. And come on to the oval straightaway, leading to the final corners.
Tell you what, you look right behind him, that 42 car, Jimmy McMurray. He's up into the 9th position, had a decent qualifying run, 14th. This is a backup car, and it's not his backup car. He crashed in practice on Friday. They did not have a backup car. This is his teammate, Reed Sorensen's backup car. And Jeff, they planned on testing this car at Phoenix next week.
And Larry, the funny thing about it, Reed Sorensen told us, hey, big guy, don't scratch my car today. And right now they're having a pretty good run, but on that first stop when they come in, he said the car is a little bit tight in the slow corners, but extremely good in the chicane and all the fast parts of this racetrack. Right now, McMurray pretty happy along with his crew chief, and I'm talking about his regular crew chief, Donnie Wingo, pretty happy with this race car.
McMurray in 9th place.
Hey, someone else I think is pretty happy with their car, at least he was yesterday, right behind him, Ron Hornaday in a 33 car. They caught him next to Kevin Harvick. But Ron was one of those cars, had to get in on qualifying. He said, Larry, I had to be conservative in my qualifying run. I couldn't afford to get off the racetrack. He started back in 21st, and he's all the way up to 10th. And behind him, we're seeing Ashton Lewis. I think he kind of locked those brakes up that time getting in the corner.
And, you know, again, thinking about front tires, you slide that front tire like that very many times, flat spot it, and you could blow that tire out.
Well, you're going to see a smoke show entering turn 4 there, Darrell. There's a dip right there, right at the start of the braking zone.
Yeah, it looks like it's where they added that turn in, and that transition is a little rough. Might be bothering everybody else, but it's not bothering that cat right there. I'm telling you.
We're going to get you some of that Canels that's on the side of Getter's car, the leader's car. It's chewing gum, and I'm told it is really spicy. That may help your throat.
Really spicy.
Yeah, my mouth's still burning from yesterday. Now, we saw at the beginning of the show that I talked about the fuel window, that these teams could run about 27 to 32 or 33 laps on fuel. That put them, when they get to lap 14, Jeff, that makes them be able to run 33 laps a run. I think we're going to see a lot of leaders come to pit road very shortly, and they hope it's under green.
Larry, you're exactly right. And for the 40 car of Carlos Contreras, that's exactly what they're thinking. They're already getting their plan together. They're getting the crew up. I look for these guys to be coming to pit road in another lap or two, and they're going to try to get out of sequence with everybody else and put themselves in a position where they can try to win. As we already see David Streaming in 14 car, he's bringing his car in. And see how he does as far as his change. It's like he's going to 4 tires, going to fill his car up full of fuel. So I'm going to look for a lot of teams to start hitting pit road anytime.
I like to get out of sequence, particularly on a road course, because if it plays out right, I'll be at the front of the field when the race is coming to the end.
Stremme in a backup car. That's why it's in black, not Blue Angel blue. And you see the right front damage on Stremme. On the right of your screen, Contreras one of two cars carrying Roche Franz. That is a Mexican brand of automotive lubricants and fluids, oils, brake fluids, and so forth.
Well, we saw Stremme on pit road. Remember, that's Contreras' teammate, so we'd anticipate a lot of those cars will be to pit road. And in the perfect world, Darrell, is it takes a minute and 27, 28 seconds to get around here, that you make your pit stop under green, and then once you make that pit stop, you hope the caution comes out. That means everyone else will come to pit road to get their four tires under caution. You'll be at the front of the pack.
Like a free pass, only better.
It's almost like you come to a road course and you put yourself in your zone and you run your own race. And then when it gets to the end, you see what the competition's like.
Saw a little smoke from the rear of Morissette's car as he locked the brakes going into turn one. His turn one, two, and three is the S's Moises Solana, a Mexican Formula One driver from 1963 to 68, who won here in a U.S. Road Racing Championship race in 68. That turn one, two, and three complex named for him.
The longer, you know, the closer it comes to a fuel or a pit stop, the more we're going to see tires lock up because they lose grip. And as they lose grip, the brakes just slide the tires.
And the only strategy when you come to pit road, since you're turning left and right, like you see them going through the S's here, is about every pit stop will be for four tires, but mainly getting that tank full of fuel.
I'm interested in the H's strategy because they're in pretty early, and they think they can make it.
Oops. Mara Reyes.
Now, if I'm a crew chief and I see this on my monitor, I can get to pit road before that caution comes out. That's what I want to do. I guarantee you I'm coming to pit road right now.
Mara from Pachuca, Mexico, two-time Tracto Trucks champion of Mexico and Mexico's best female race driver.
Now, David Stremme, he wants that caution to come out right now. That way he would be leading the race after the sequence of pit stops. And we're seeing some of our leaders hit pit road right there. There you see Contreras in the 40 car, Harvick in the 21, Hornaday in the 33.
I mean, you got to anticipate there's going to be a caution pit now. That's what I'd be doing.
Jeff?
Well, Eddie Buffett made the call right now. Here comes Carlos Contreras into the 40 car. They're going to go to work and get four tires right now, and the caution is out. So these guys are going to get a big break. They can take their time, make the necessary adjustments on this, and not lose any valuable track time. As we look up the way, we can also see that looks like Ron Hornaday in the 33 car is also in. So all these guys are going to get a free pit stop, basically.
Yeah, just remember, the minute the caution flag waved, they close pit road. As long as you're past that flagman, when you're coming on the pit road, as we see J.J. Yaley in the 18 car as well, then you're okay. It's a free pit stop.
And there's Yaley completing his stop. The free pass rule is in effect here at Mexico City. NASCAR has brought it back to the road races. And in this case, the free pass car would be the 43 of Ramirez.
What you would anticipate, a lot of the teams are using three or four spotters around this racetrack because it's so big and there's so many blind spots. Where we see the 49 car that's sitting over there, Reyes' car, wherever those spotters are, there you see some of the spotters now, they would be telling that crew chief, look, we may have a caution. You might want to think about pitting now.
And Larry, as you watch this replay that we're going to see here, I think somebody got on the radio and hollered at the 72 car, Ruben Garcia, who's going to see this. He gets run over here by the 43 car, I believe that is. It already had damage.
Yep.
And that's one of his countrymen.
Ramirez.
So why don't you slow down in front of me? Because the caution is out.
So we're under caution for the second time in Mexico City. 18 laps have been completed. And Mara Reyes, Mexico's best woman driver, getting a push out of the gravel trap and hopefully for her, back into the race. Laps complete in Mexico City. NASCAR's first ever Busch Series race outside the United States. And local hero Jorge Getters has led every single lap. Teammate to David Green in a Bruco-owned Ford. He's out front. Ron Fellows, the Canadian driver and one of our regular road course ringers, in second. Boris Said, another ringer who's going to also drive 10 oval races this year for MB Sutton Racing and Nextel Cup, running third. Leader stays out, but pit road becomes a busy place. Most of the cars behind him came in.
That has got to be some sort of communication problem.
Jeff?
When Michelle Jourdain brings in his fifth-place car, right now, Todd Green, Gordon, he says the car is really good, running a little bit warm. They're going to pull some tape off the front. He doesn't want to take a chance. It's only 220 degrees, but they're a little bit concerned about that, and they're also making a little bit of an air pressure adjustment. Matt?
And Ron Fellows trying for a fourth NASCAR Busch Series victory. His pit road, a little bit of trouble on the left front, having to put the lug on. Now the changer getting around to that right front, losing some valuable time as the 27 is already away. Palmenard to the 11's away. Fellows didn't want any adjustments. Tough break here on pit road. Loses a number of positions, 22.5 seconds, Mike Joy.
And Darrell, this is not the widest pit road to have to get off of when there's a lot of traffic.
Oh no, it's very narrow, and it's a lot. It reminds me of Dover in that respect, in that regard. But I'm worried about the 66. I'm not sure what their strategy would be.
So our leader did not pit, nor did the 42 of Jamie McMurray, or Carl Edwards in the 60 are now lined up right behind him.
Larry, are they trying to get into that window, that magic spot where they can make it on one more stop?
Yeah, they may not be there just yet because we still have 61 laps to go. I talked about the fuel window, 27 to 32 laps. A lot of those cars were in the 27 to 28 lap range. So I'd say a lot of these cars will hit pit road shortly after we go back to racing.
At number 21, though, Kevin Harvick, listen to one driver who is very happy that he pitted when he did just before the yellow came out.
Those are the kind of things that win road races. You got to make the right calls, have a few things go your way. The rest of these are just laps. They don't mean anything. So we just got to put ourselves in the right position.
10-4. We were just watching TV and thought that was the thing to do.
Now that was definitely right.
Well, as you look down pit road and you look at Harvick's car with a Hershey product, Pelon Pelo Rico, made here, a Hershey product made here in Mexico there. Go down to his pit, and or let's go down to the pits. And Matt in the leader's pit, remember the leader did not stop.
Newt Moore told me before the race, Newt, you said that lap 25 window, are you sticking to that? Is that why you didn't pit?
Yeah, I think if you just pit twice here like you do at Watkins Glen and all them other places, it'll be the right move. Tires are good. He's just taking it easy right now. He's really smooth. This kid is just awesome. So we'll see if we can keep it up front. But yeah, we're going to stay around 25, 26, 27. We'll come down then, get our tires green, yellow, whatever the case may be, and go to our next window and stop and see where we come out.
And Darrell, you know as a driver, the team keeps preaching him, be patient, don't over-abuse your stuff. We have a game plan. We're going to stick to it.
Well, he's doing a good job, I tell you that.
Way back behind him, Darrell, let's do the math. Adrian Fernandez, who had to start with a provisional in a backup car after a qualifying crash, has gained 28 positions. The number 7 of Chris Cook has gained a lot of spots. Johnny Sauter has picked up 15. And yes, folks, that is an active volcano off in the distance. We like to say things are heating up. Hopefully, not that much.
Nobody told me about that.
It's miles from here, Darrell. So Getters is our leader. Fellows is second. Jamie McMurray up to third after pit stops. Boris Sett is fourth. Paul Menard was fifth the last time they came by the line. And that, of course, will sort out and change with the pit stops.
Yeah, best I can tell, Mike, the top five cars did not pit that time. We already talked about Jorge Getters and Jamie McMurray, Carl Edwards, Elliott Sadler in the 90 car did not pit as well. And then that puts Martin Truex Jr. in the fifth position. Remember, he made the pit stop back on lap 9 in the 8 car.
Green flag once again after the second caution of the day is cleaned up. All restarts are single file.
Kind of like they do Formula One.
McMurray looking inside for the lead, but he really didn't have the good entry line to turn one.
And so far after 20 laps, that's the closest that anyone has come to getting by Jorge Getters is on a restart getting into turn one, but it pretty much ends there. So we already 20 laps in this race. We have all types of agendas. We have cars that will have to beat a pit road in the next 4 or 5 laps. We have Martin Truex Jr. that will have to beat a pit road probably in about 25 to 30 laps. And then we have a lot of our guys back there that were leading the race. They can go now about 30 or 35 more laps.
Randy LaJoy and J.J. Yaley both just made pit stops as we went back to green. Daryl, those S's go on forever.
They do. They just there's two series of them. There's the initial ones after you leave turn four. You think you're out of them, but all of a sudden you got another set pops right up.
We're hearing that the 49 car Mara Reyes had a clutch problem. She lost her clutch. That's the reason she could not get back on.
That's David Green to the inside. There's Fellows trying to work his way back up after pit stops, as is the one of Boris Sed. And Menard hits pit lane in the 11th.
You know, you can tell these drivers have all been kind of warned or cautioned to give each other a break.
Now this is a
we've been real clean so far.
That's an unscheduled pit stop for Paul Menard because he pitted the last time on lap 19.
We saw Adrian Fernandez make a pass, carefully working his way up through. He's been in the fence twice this weekend, very uncharacteristic. And folks that had the watches out said yesterday he was on what would have been a pole-winning run had he not crashed in the S's.
You ever heard that?
Oh, yeah, many times.
Matt, what's the matter with Paul Menard?
A tough break for this young man. They are thinking the sway bar arm may have broken on this 11 car. Many in the garage area felt like he would be the dark horse driver today. It is hanging down as the crew is working underneath that right front suspension.
Well, we already talked about the curbs down in the chicane and all. They stick up so high, very well, he may have hit one of those curbs and busted the sway bar arm off.
Yeah, these are bigger curbs than we see normal at the road course. They're much taller.
Martin Truex has moved past Carl Edwards to pick up a spot, and Robbie Gordon has brought his car from behind the wall back into the race.
Didn't sound any better, was it?
Nope.
Still running rough.
That turn eight is a good place to get a launch and try to get a run alongside somebody coming to this chicane, but things funnel up there in a hurry.
That turn eight is, you get into seven and eight there, it's huge. You're coming around there, you really don't see all the way around the turn until you get all the way around the turn.
Teammates side by side entering the corner, John Wood, Stacy Compton. And Wood completes the pass. Up and over the curb goes Kevin Harvick. And Chris Cook in the seven. A lot of curb jumping here, like we see out at Infineon Raceway.
Kevin's got him set up pretty good if he can outbreak him now.
Chris Cook in the seven car, remember, he had to go to the rear of the field at the start of the race because of the engine change. He moved up pretty quick when they started this race.
Entering turn four, Harvick Hornaday there to the inside, and Cook loses another spot to Clint Boyer in the two.
He's had another car make an unscheduled pit stop, Michelle Jourdain in the 10 car. He was just on pit road that last caution as well, just made another pit stop.
Rusty Wallace up into the top 10, driving a number 64 Dodge. Bell Helicopters has sponsored Rusty here this weekend. He's found his way up into the top 10.
Started back in 31st, but he was one of those cars that pitted back on lap 9. So he's on that agenda of he will have to basically make two more pit stops.
And I think one of the reasons he didn't qualify well is he was one of the first cars out the other day. And the track just wasn't that good when he first started qualifying.
And Darrell, I would have to believe a lot of these cars, like Mark Truex Jr. in the 8 car, the black car out there, that what they're banking on when they pitted on lap 9 is that we'll have a lot of cautions to cushion their fuel mileage. You figure about a 2-to-1 ratio here, cautions to green laps.
There's a look at Rusty Wallace.
Getting a report that Michelle Jourdain had caved the grill in that lets the air flow into the radiator, and he was starting to overheat just a little bit.
I think John Wood, who said he wasn't the least bit at home on these road courses, is starting to reel in Rusty.
Well, the more laps you run, the more comfortable you get. So he's learning the course, learning where to hit his marks, shift gears.
Turn five here, this left-hander. That leads into that long set of S's. You see here.
They just go on forever.
Kevin Harvick, Carlos Contreras in a pretty good battle. Back in 12th place and the 59 of Stacy Compton just ahead of Harvick. You're riding with Kevin Harvick.
And all these are cars that made that pit stop right before that last caution or on that caution as Stacy Compton in the 59. We know for a fact
that they only have to make one more pit stop. I like their position, and I like their strategy.
I tell you, a guy that just keeps coming to the front, Larry, and I don't think we've heard the last of him, is the five car of Adrian Fernandez. He's up to fifth place, or fourth place, and the car looks really good. I think he's gotten comfortable in that car he hadn't even made a lap in.
Trouble for Carl Edwards, who, well, maybe it's trouble, maybe it's schedule, but...
It's a scheduled pit stop, Mike. Remember, this will be his first trip to pit road here on lap 24. So from here, green or yellow, he should be able to make it on one stop.
So Edwards completing his stop from his Brad Parent crew. Jorge Gutierrez, the leader, won the pole, has been out front the entire race, has not made a stop, but we've completed 24 laps and expect him in the next lap or two to make his first stop of the day.
We should see him, Jamie McMurray in the 42, as well as Elliott Sadler in the 90 car. Those guys should be to pit road very shortly.
And if they stop, that would hand the lead to Martin Truex Jr., who came in on the first caution.
And already has paid off, his strategy has, because he's going to get 5 bonus points.
Jamie McMurray, the second place car, had his hand out the window signaling to Truex that he would pit, and he is going to follow Gutierrez into the pit lane.
Now this may be one of the most difficult things Gutierrez does all day long.
I think he's made a mistake, Darrell. He slowed down to pit road speed way before the timing line.
See, he's never made a pit stop.
Exactly. The first time, we talked about it in the opening, the first time he's ever had to do this, Matt Yokel.
And Larry Mack knew more, told him, remember to get to pit road speed, 4,500 RPM at the cones. That's why he tried to jump down, Jeff Hammond.
Right now, Jamie McMurray brings it down. Donnie Wingo, along with Tony Glover, they made the call to come on in. This is a planned stop. Get 4 tires, get this thing full of fuel, and get on the sequence that they've been looking for all day long. He says the car is still working well. Just make a little bit of air pressure adjustment, Matt.
Jeff Hammond, a big miscue. The inexperience showing with Jorge Gutierrez. He slowed way too much, almost came to a stop in Martin Truex's pit box, losing a lot of valuable time here on pit road. The car was tight. They were going to make an air pressure adjustment to free him up as the 42 car. Jamie McMurray, you can see how much time he lost out here road by how much track position McMurray has gained. 20 seconds for the 66.
But I saw mistakes by Jorge Gutierrez by getting into his pit box. You saw some mistakes by the pit crew. We talked in the opening. These guys are not used to making pit stops like this. Jimmy McMurray's crew, the 42 team, that's his next El Cup team. They made pit stops like this.
So Jorge Gutierrez making his first NASCAR pit stop. Over conservative entering the pits, got down to pit road speed too soon, slow getting into his pit box, and very costly.
Lucky that McMurray didn't run over him, because he had to lock him up to keep running into him.
And that also, that slow entry to the pit lane, also hurt McMurray, because once you get into that pit lane entrance, you're not allowed to pass. Martin Truex Jr. leading his first laps of this season in the NASCAR Busch Series. Busch Series Racing on Fox, presented by America Online, is brought to you by Smooth Busch Beer and Easy Drinking Busch Light. Caution is out for the third time today at the Rodriguez Brothers Circuit in Mexico City. This is Mara Reyes, who was off at turn number one into the trap, gravel trap, and was pushed out back on course. Now, just before the caution came out, here goes Tyler Walker out there. And if you stop in that gravel trap, it's very hard to get going. That's designed to slow and stop the car. But look at the ex-dirt track star wheel it on out of there.
I don't think that's what they were thinking when they put great clips on the car.
No.
He was running in third position when he did that.
But that's some of that good dirt track racing experience paying off.
Comes back on at turn three, just in front of Kevin Harvick.
He only lost about 4 or 5 positions.
Yeah, normally a guy gets on the brakes and locks it down and buries it right there.
All right, let's go back to the pit stop of the man who led the first 19 laps of this race, Jorge Gutierrez, coming down at pit road speed.
It's only 35 mile an hour now, the pit road speed is, so it's really slow.
And looking for his pit stall now
actually stopped in Martin Truex Jr.'s pit box, the one behind him, so that cost him some time. But again, in his defense, I would have to say, I think I'm pretty confident saying this is the first time he's ever had to do that. There you see his crew chief, Newt Moore, had a car that led the first 25 laps of this race.
I'm sorry, Larry, I can't let him off the hook that easy. They had a big signboard with his car number right out in front of his pit, right where he needed to stop the front bumper. Now, they don't make a lot of pit stops in the Corona Challenge Series here in Mexico, and they only allow two people over the wall to service the car. So, yes, this is new to him, but the signboard was there right where he needed to stop.
I'm not so sure that we have no radio transmission to back it up, but I bet when he came on pit road too slow, they started getting on him and telling him to come on down here. But then when he got down here, I think he was a little panicked.
It's a shame because it spoils a fine drive from the start of this race. He qualified on pole and led the first, I said 19, actually he led the first 24 laps before making his pit stop.
Now, speaking of pit stops, we're not seeing a lot of pit stops. Most of these cars you see on pit road, like the McDonald's car, that would be Jason Keller, Ron Hornaday back there, Chris Cook. These are cars that were in the back of the pack, although we do see Carl Edwards in the 60 car. He's back on pit road. And again, these guys, it would be hard for them to make it in one more stop.
Hey. This is not the lucky dog or the free pass. This is not even funny because... Here's Matt.
Big congestion, Mike Joy, leaving pit road. The 35 and 59 cars, close call, possibly coming together, but the 60 of Edwards on pit road, they made a track bar adjustment on the first stop. Brad Parrott felt like, take the time, that car. They wanted to put a spring rubber in the right rear, also make an air pressure adjustment. And Darrell, you know as a driver, you can really help your effort by being easy on that pedal under caution, saving fuel. And that's one thing that Brad Parrott was questioning Carl Edwards. How have you been doing on fuel under this caution?
Yeah, because you shift gears so much. I mean, you can ride around here in second gear, goosing it all the time, cleaning off your tires, and waste a lot of fuel.
And talking it over in Adrian Fernandez pit.
That's Jim Long, crew chief on the 5 car.
Up and over.
Right through the hole in the fence.
Happy ending.
Give that dog a bone.
We're back under green as Martin Truex leads him off turn number 3. Mexico City is also the home of the world's largest bullfighting arena, and this crowd senses their local Matador hero, Adrian Fernandez, looking in from second place, looking for the lead.
I was going to say, we're not even halfway. You talked about the 100,000 people. All of them are standing up right now wanting him to get the lead in this race.
I don't believe he's got much for Truex right now. I thought he might be able to pounce on him, but Truex is pulling away, and now Shane Neal is all over the back end of Fernandez.
Remember that Fernandez, number 5, is a backup car and not the purpose-built road course car that many folks thought he would easily have won the pole with had he not crashed on his time trial lap. And how about Shane Neal? Here's a guy with no road racing experience. He's come down here, ate the local food, drank the water, had a blast, and he's up there trying to race for the lead.
These people there are waving him on.
He got a run right there. Adrian got off the track. Adrian's going to block him going down here to this game.
I tell you, another guy having a great run right behind this group in that 41, that white car, Reed Sorensen. Not only does he not have a lot of road course experience, this is only his 8th Busch Series start, period.
And he may well leave here with the point standing lead.
Let me tell you, that kid right there, he's the next big deal.
One car off, that was the 87 of Fellows, who may have got ridden off the course there at turn 4 or 5, and now they come down the oval straight.
Oh, yeah. He almost ran the back of the 64 car there. That's Rusty's car.
All right, that was in turn one. He skips turn two, hops back on track. And because he comes back behind Clint Boyer, and because he did not gain position, no penalty for leaving the racing surface.
These road racing guys, like Ron Fellows and Boyce said, they just can get in the turn so much deeper than a round track specialist can.
I like what he did there, Darrell. Rather than challenge and tear up the car in that corner, resource management, took the car off track at a place where he knew he could easily get back on.
Smart driver. I like Ron Fellows a lot. Really smart. You don't win 24-hour races all over the world without being smart.
Jeff, how about the second place car of Adrian Fernandez?
Mike, right now, crew chief Jim Long is feeling very confident that that last caution is going to put him in give him an opportunity to make a pit stop around lap 45. One more stop, and he'll have Adrian where he needs to be. Right now, the car's a little bit tight. He's having a little bit of trouble through the course because of that reason, but he feels like his next air pressure adjustment will be all this hometown boy needs to really give him an opportunity to take this car to victory lane.
Trouble here on the 36 of Stanton Barrett, very slow. You saw 38 Tyler Walker in the Great Clips car off the track briefly.
Look at that mess.
Yeah, this is the eye of a storm, Darrell.
Well, what happens is it just backs up, bottlenecks up. There's Getters up in the middle of that, too.
Yep, 66. Nowhere for him to go. He's right behind McMurray trying to bust his way back through. And Ron Fellows has had trouble again. Let's ride with him right behind the 20 of Denny Hamlin.
He's just trying to miss the man.
Whoa, yeah. He just creeping
way through.
Spin in front of him again. Turn one, calamity corner.
And then here's what happens there. 36 spins out right in front of him.
Dodge it again.
I bet he's taking his lucky starters.
Well, the biggest thing that's costing him, and he's now almost 7.5 seconds behind our leader, Martin Truex Jr. at 8. But now, just to update you on those top four cars, Martin Truex Jr., Adrian Fernandez, Shane Mill, and Reed Sorensen. They pitted last time on lap 9. We got a battle for the lead here. Looks like the 5 car, Adrian Fernandez, had taken the lead.
Oh, Truex crossover move. But now he's out of position for turn three. Fernandez is going to exit turn three with the lead. And when the crowd sees it on the screen, they are going to erupt.
They want him to come back around and lead this lap.
Only two leaders so far today, Jorge Getters and Martin Truex Jr. Truex to the inside.
Boy, Martin is just really aggressive.
You know what's neat, though? This is the two teams that battled for the championship last year. The 5 car of Hendrick, Martin Truex Jr., the 8 car owned by Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Therese Earnhardt. Just remember what I was about to say before we almost had the battle for lead. Those top four cars you see right there, they will have to be on pit road in about 12 laps to make this work. And in my book, they've made their bed. They're going to have to lay in it now.
Out of turn six, here they come down the oval straight into turn seven, and when Fernandez emerges from turn eight with the lead, these 100,000 Mexican fans will go bananas.
You got a good run off turn eight. Just look at the crowd. From last to first in 33 laps.
Talked to Drew Brown, his PR guy. He said Adrian Fernandez in this city is, he said he blows Dale Jr., Jeff Gordon, Tony Stewart, all those guys away.
Paul Menard's had a spin, cut down a right rear tire and damage.
Looks like you already had the damage, and that may have been what cut that tire down. The quarter panel, you see it all sticking out. The guy that had a great qualifying run, ran up in the top 5 or 6 most of the first part of the race, his troubles will continue. Right, there you see Martin Truex Jr. His pit crew, remember, we talk about track temperature all the time. Matt, they're trying to see if it's changing any for one more adjustment or one more stop.
Larry Mack, you can feel the wind has picked up, and it is getting cooler down here on pit road. Now, Bono Mannion just cautioned his driver 2 laps ago. You know the 5 is like the head of state here. He's going to try to get out front and lead for the home crowd. Stick to our game plan. Let's save our stuff. We're going to pit and run 11 or 12 more laps.
Well, I tell you one thing, Martin didn't give it to him. I mean, he worked him hard.
But just look at that track temperature, 70 degrees. It was 86 degrees when this race started 33 laps ago.
A partisan crowd. cheering Adrian Fernandez. And speaking of heads of state, Mexican President Vicente Fox among the spectators here, as is the U.S. Ambassador to Mexico, Antonio Garcia, among the 110,000 fans here.
They rolled out the red carpet. There's no question about that.
Adrian Fernandez leads in the Lowe's Chevrolet in Mexico City. Busch Series Racing on Fox is presented by America Online. Want a better internet? You belong at America Online. Welcome back to Mexico City, where Adrian Fernandez just lost the lead to Martin Truex Jr. Fernandez got up on the rumble strips, and that opened the door for Truex. Shane Neal at third, trying to hold off Reed Sorensen as they go into turn five.
Harvick
and,
right there.
Yep, Kevin Harvick in that white and green number 21. Carlos Contreras right behind him, another great effort for the former Craftsman Truck Series driver. Let's show you the lead change.
Coming down to turn one here. Hooked it in there nice. See the problem there.
Lead change happening coming out of turn number three. Another driver having trouble at that corner, our pole sitter, Jorge Getters, has had a spin and dropped back to 26th position. Well, Truex is not point chasing, Darrell. He's a man on a mission.
When he and Fernandez got up there racing each other, I was surprised how aggressive Martin was being. I think that Fernandez had got some problems.
Here comes Shane Neal to the inside. Fernandez leaves him just enough room. Has the line in two. Whoa. Oh, Michelle Jourdain.
That's big.
Caution is out.
He's
caution
crashed
is
hard.
Out.
Looks like down here in 7 and 8.
Turn 8. You see two flags in use. The yellow flag, which is the caution flag, and the blue flag, which usually in road racing means a faster car is coming up on you. Here, NASCAR has instructed the drivers the blue flag would be used to indicate sand, fluid, or some other problem on the course. Here's the lead change. Jourdain goes behind the wall. And under this caution flag, we're told that David Stremme, who is suffering from a bit of the flu, will be replaced by J.J. Yaley, whose car is already out of the race.
Now, this is what's interesting about these cautions. We were talking, as you see, Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car and the cars behind him, Fernandez in the 5, Mill in the 32, Reed Sorensen in the 41. They are about 5 or 6 laps away from their window. Pitting right here necessarily would not do them any good unless they would be banking on the fact they could get enough cautions to buy them the distance. They did not want this caution flag right here.
Well, you know what you got to do then, if that's the case, stay out until it's right, until it's one to go.
Because we heard Matt Yoakum talking to Bono Mannion, Martin Truex Jr.'s crew chief. He can run about 34, 35 laps. So when he pitted on lap 9, he needs to go to lap 44 to make that stop.
See the red with black flag, the X flag being waved. Pit road not, is pit road open?
No,
no
it's not
it's
open.
Not open. That's, I thought I saw the flag on the outside of turn 8, showing the drivers that pit road has not yet opened.
The longer they keep pit road closed, the better off for these guys. That's one more lap getting closer to their window.
Here's what happens to Michelle Jourdain. He gets tagged by Carl Edwards.
Yep.
That's Carl behind him in the 60. Yep.
Ouch. That's two hard hits this weekend for Jourdain.
Yeah, his throttle hung on him in practice Friday when he had a hard crash. That was a backup car.
38 laps complete, closing in on halfway under caution in Mexico. By New Q from Quaker State, the heat-activated oil that helps maximize the power of your engine. 38 laps complete. We're under caution for Michelle Jourdain's crash. We're two laps shy of halfway at the Autodromo Hermanos Rodriguez in Mexico City, Mexico. Next weekend, NASCAR moves to Las Vegas. Our coverage begins Friday on Speed Channel with Nextel Cup qualifying and Busch Series qualifying. Then Saturday, Nextel Cup practice, followed by the Busch Series race presented by TGIF on FX. Sunday begins with NASCAR this morning on Speed Channel, leading up to the Nextel Cup race on Fox. And then NASCAR Victory Lane on Speed wraps up the whole weekend. NASCAR across the Fox networks all next weekend. Matt?
Mike, Elliott Sadler is not a happy camper. The original game plan was to go to lap 37. Then they decided to stretch it to lap 39. He is now out of fuel. Elliott's upset because they deviated from their original game plan. He's now looking for a push. And Jeff Hammond, believe it or not, I'm feeling a few sprinkles down here.
Matt, unfortunately, I'm feeling the same thing down here on the other end of pit road. We're taking a look right now at Michelle Jourdain's car. The crew is working very feverishly trying to get the front nose cut off, replace the radiator and everything to try to get him back out. Remember, they're running for points. And I know this is not exactly what Michelle wanted to have happen to him today. It's not the way you wanted to kind of have your show as far as your hometown's concerned. What happened on the racetrack?
Well, as I went into the last corner, a black car, I don't know who was that. I mean, he was far behind me, and when I drove into the corner, I knew he was inside me, but I gave him space inside of me, and he just still hit me. It's very slippery out there, and I think he just went straight into me.
As you can tell, he's pretty disappointed right now, but the crew is trying to get him back on the racetrack.
Thanks, Jeff. The driver that got into Jourdain was Carl Edwards. Here is Elliott Sadler trying to make it to his pit.
And we're on one to go.
Yeah, we thought we had lost track of him making a pit stop.
Let me know where the pace car is.
We do a pretty good job of staying on top of it, and we could not find where he had made a pit stop. I could find...
The pace car is just starting to get to turn four now. Okay, guys, what we talked about, four tires, fuel, and adjustment.
So he'll be about half a lap behind when they wave the green flag.
Well, he's finally made it to his pit box. They're going to change four tires, filling up with fuel. I couldn't find anyone that could run this far on fuel, so I'm not surprised he's out.
Now let's have a look at the lead change that put Martin Truex Jr. back out front in the number eight. Through the chicane.
So you can see the car slides out right there. And when it does,
wow. Oh
my gosh, that's got that Carl Edwards look to it. And look at the fender on the... left front of the five car. Did a little damage to it, too.
So there's Truex, who made the crossover and took the inside line. David Stremme is out of his car, has now relief from J.J. Yaley.
Let me tell you, Mike, this is a tough road course. Even though we've had a lot of cautions, those S's in this track will wear you out.
Trying to get it's had the refired. Not like that, Matt.
Trying to get the fire out. They were spraying ether in that cowl area while they were completing the pit stop because he was out of fuel. Luckily, that is a NASCAR mandated fire suit trying to put that fire out. Tough break for this team. They came in here expecting good things. Elliott excited about running this weekend. Tough break for this team.
All right, let me explain why the crewman puts his arm over that. It's to block off the air supply that's feeding the flame and trying to snuff it out that way.
Off his wrench!
Oh, tough break.
Do I need to get out?
Yes. Yes, I'd get out.
And this is a car that qualified 10.
They're fast started, Elliott.
Been running in the top 10 the whole race.
Well, if it'll start, that'll put the fire out. But here comes the pace car. We're ready to get back under green. They'll take the halfway sign with the green flag at lap 40. And Elliott Sadler,
I think
we'll go a lap down as they come by.
Well, let's see. Yeah, I think you're right, Mike. He's going to be on the roll when he gets there.
Green flag. And here comes Harvick, pounding on the outside. He's going to go all the way to second place. Wow.
That was a legal move, though. They told him in the driver's meeting, when the green flag comes out, you can pass to the left. That's what he did.
Yeah.
He took advantage.
They didn't say you had to keep all four tires on the pavement, did they?
No, sir.
Harvick to second.
Just remember, Harvick in the 21, Kevin Harvick on a little fresher tires. He pitted back on lap 17. He can go a little bit further than these guys. We're going to see Martin Truex Jr. in the 8, Fernandez in the 5, and Sorensen in the 41 to pit road in about 3 or 4 laps.
Now, that was a great move by Kevin, assuming that he didn't go too soon.
Har- Harvick to the inside. That long, looping, decreasing radius, turn four. If you're on the inside there, it doesn't set you up well for turn five, and now they come to the essence.
Kevin's car's handling good, quite a bit better than the 8 car is.
But he's on those fresher tires.
Fresher tires.
The 8 car's on 30, 32-lap tires. That's the reason you're seeing those top three or four besides Harvick really start to slide around.
Harvick's move to the left was legal and was legally timed. As the flag came out, Harvick made his move to the left and got his jump. And don't forget who drives Kevin Harvick's car, the king of restarts, Ron Hornaday.
But I tell you, Kevin Harvick in the 21 and Carlos Contreras back in the 40 car. We still have half this race to go, but I'm going to tell you, the move of the race could be Rick Byers, Kevin Harvick's crew chief, the 21, and Ann Buffington, Carly Contreras' crew chief, by getting those guys on the pit road on lap 17 right before the caution came out.
There's Hornaday in the 33, or excuse me, it's not. It's Carlos Contreras in the 40, locking him up a bit as he's under pressure from the one of Boris Sedd. Ron Fellows has climbed back up to seventh place, right behind Sedd. Clint Bowyer having a fine trouble-free run in eighth in the number two. Then ninth, Denny Hamlin also having a good rookie run for his outing, and Rusty Wallace in tenth.
We have a lot of guys up there in the top 10 that does not have a lot of road course experience.
Yeah, but we got a couple that really have a lot. Boris Sedd and Ron Fellows.
Yes, we do.
And they're just, again, they'll be there. One race on the road course, I'll take Ron Fellows.
I will say these next two or three laps for that 8 car, for that 5 car, that 41, is going to be nail-biting, because if they can make it to that lap 44, which is two to go, then we know they probably can make it to the end without stopping.
Martin Truex Jr., the Busch Series champion, under heavy pressure from Kevin Harvick as they complete 42 laps. Coming to complete 44 laps in Mexico City, defending Busch Series champion Martin Truex Jr., who's led 15 laps today, out in front with Kevin Harvick, curb jumping and shortcutting and doing everything he can, trying to close that gap and take the lead. Now Harvick drives for Richard Childress, who owns his Cup car. Harvick owns the 33, driven by Ron Hornaday, and you see Hornaday get tagged by our pole sitter, Jorge Getters.
Yeah, he didn't,
around.
He didn't have his blinker on. He turned hard left. That was not good.
He was back there running in the 16th position before that happened.
Look at Harvick hop these curbs, Darrell.
You know what? That car, that paint, oh, look there.
Ron Fellows in 87. He was running in the 6th position.
Boy, Ron's having a tough go of it. One way to keep him from winning.
The road course ringers are not getting a lot of respect. A lot of respect from the Busch Series regulars here.
He's one of those cars that pitted back on lap 17, lap 19, so you heard him say about four more laps. We anticipate Martin Truex Jr., an 8-car leader, should be the pit road either this time or maybe the next lap. Yeah. They've had 10 cautions since he pitted. That buys him a little extra fuel mileage.
See what happened to Ron Fellows?
Got to run out of the chicane, headed down to turn one.
Trying Carlos Contreras.
Gets alongside of him there. But we see, how many times have we seen that? Turn one and around turn two there, people get spun out.
It's like Contreras got up on the curb and jumped over into Ron Fellows, into his quarter panel, and turned him around.
It's so hard to go through turn two, especially there, that little left-hander side by side. Jeff?
Well, right now I'm standing behind the 5-car pit of Adrian Fernandez. They're getting ready to bring that car down pit road. Just a few laps earlier, Ryan Patty on the 41 car, Reed Sorensen, came down to check with Jim Long to see when they were coming so they wouldn't have any kind of problems getting in and getting out. And the way it works out, Brian Patty thinks they're going to wait and come an extra lap. They don't know too sure about it right now because the 41 car guys have already just jumped down. Look like they're going to make a pit stop also, Matt.
Service already going on the 60 car of Carl Edwards. The chassis adjustment already completed.
The car was tight all over, went up on the track bar. And the 64 car, Rusty Wallace on pit road as well. The 60's down and away. The 60's away as well.
Will this be the first of the wave of the final pit stop for these guys? They know they can make it from here to the end. There's see Martin Truex Jr., Nate, waving to Kevin Harvick in the 21. You just wonder, is he possibly out of fuel? But he's definitely coming to pit road this time. Cannot have a mistake. 35 miles per hour, and the pit crew has to be solid. He's all the way down to the end of pit road near the exit.
Right there is where pit road speed begins, 150 feet before the first pit. So, oh, trouble, as that is Ruben Garcia Novoa in the fence.
All right, Reed Sorensen in the 41, Martin Truex Jr., Nate. This is a great break for them because the caution will come out. They get this free pit stop, as well as Boris Sid, Fernandez, Jamie McMurray. Everyone else will have to pit under caution, and they'll be behind them. The timing was perfect.
Not by your time.
Matt?
Mike, that's exactly what Bodo Mannion just told Martin Truex as the sprinkles begin again. So this is a huge break for us. No chassis adjustments on the eight cars. The Jackman stumbled a little bit coming around the car. Haskell Lavalette grabbing the lugs on the right rear. The five is down and away. The 41's away. And there goes Truex.
On the 41, they just went.
Reed Sorensen comes off the pit lane. We are under caution for the Novoa crash. He went heavily into the tire wall. As there's Fernandez, who's completed his pit stop.
Boy, he got out of his pit box in a hurry.
And our new leader will be Kevin Harvick.
He being the five car.
Harvick finished second the last 2 weeks in the Busch Series, but this will be the first time he has led a lap this year.
But the bad news is, Mike, we know he's going to have to come to pit road and make a pit stop, whether it's this lap or a lap or so ahead, to get to his field window. That's the bad news for him. And remember, he was the one that benefited from a very similar situation back on lap 17.
Let's get an update on Reed Sorensen's stop. Here's Jeff.
Mike, I'm telling you right now, Reed Sorensen's crew, they did an awesome job. Just an awesome pit stop because they got him in and out, I mean, so quickly right now, got all the adjustments they needed to get done to this car, and they've really got this young man pumped up. Brian Patty has done an excellent job of keeping him under control, keeping all four tires on the track, which is going to be the key for them having a successful day. Matt?
Now, Jeff, Bodo Mannion just told Martin we are in good shape. When we go back to green, we should have two cars in front of us, the 60 of Edwards and the 64 of Rusty Wallace. They pitted the lap before we did. Just save your stuff under this caution. Conserve fuel best you can. We should be good to go the distance.
So Martin Truex Jr. and Reed Sorensen benefit from the timing of their pit stops. May have put themselves in a position to win here in Mexico City. One driver that has impressed me tremendously is Carlos Contreras in the number 40. He's running in second place. He spent two seasons in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. He also ran two races in the Busch Series in 2003. He's a two-time Mustang series champion here in Mexico. That's a spec series of identically prepared cars. But he has had a great race there. He's not been out of the top five all day, I don't think.
He qualified there. He was there in practice. You're absolutely right. I mean, it played right into his hand as well.
Kevin Harvick, the leader under caution for a crash by Ruben Garcia Novoa. Welcome back to Mexico City, where the traffic jam is right here on pit road. Jeff.
Right now, our leader, that was our leader, Kevin Harvick, just completed his pit stop. The guys, he was a little bit upset because he was going to try to lead a lap whenever Martin Truex came off the pit road. And
what happened? They got burnt by that caution right there, and Ricky Byers was a little bit disappointed, but his teammate, Clint Boyer, he's pretty excited. He's got a great race car. He came in, made an adjustment last stop, and he said, man, I'm ready to rock and roll. He's in third place.
So what Jeff's saying is that when Truex pitted, Harvick stayed out to lead a lap. He gained 5 points, but he lost a lot of track position. There's our pole sitter in the 66. Jorge Getters, pole sitter and runner-up in yesterday's support race, who led the first 24 laps of this race and then had a spin. But he climbed back up to seventh place at the time of this pit stop.
And he was probably a little relieved that this pit stop was under caution and not under green as the first one was. But just to update, remember the seven cars that caution really played into their hand. Martin Truex Jr. in the 8, Jamie McMurray in the 42, Boris Said in the 1, Reed Sorensen in the 41, Adrian Fernandez in the 5, as well as Carl Edwards in the 60 and Rusty Wallace in the 64. Those seven cars pitted before pit road was closed when the caution was displayed.
While today is the first points-paying race for a major NASCAR series, a national touring series in history, NASCAR did run some exhibition races in Japan in Suzuka and Motegi. They were exhibition non-points-paying races to what was then the Winston Cup Series. However, to induce the Winston West Series teams to attend, they did receive points at Suzuka, so put a little asterisk here.
But the biggest thing about this race, over a $2 million purse. It paid right at $40,000 just to start this race. That's something the Busch Series is not used to.
NASCAR drivers have a rich history racing in Mexico, the Carrera Panamericana. First run in the early 1950s, and Oregon's Herschel McGriff, the inaugural winner, a longtime NASCAR star.
Figure this. Bill France Sr. and Curtis Turner teamed up to run the Mexican road race.
That was a six-day race, Darrell. I don't think we would have been covering that one.
Saw the 18 of Mark Truex Jr. reviewing their pit stop. There's an overhead camera that takes a picture of the pit stop, and as soon as it's over, they go back to evaluate their performance.
Well, how about strategy from here, Jeff?
Well, Mike, interestingly enough, we talked to a lot of the veteran drivers, such as Boris Said and Kevin Harvick and Rusty Wallace and Elliott Sadler, and they told me that they were going to try to keep their car intact, keep it on the track to like lap 60. And at lap 60, they were definitely going to turn up the heat. But with all this pit strategy and the way things are kind of playing out, it's making me wonder if these drivers are going to kind of vary their strategy a little bit over this final run to get themselves in a position for a good finish.
Oh, Jeff, that's always the case. You know, strategy, it usually goes out the window because of caution flags.
22 laps to go in the inaugural NASCAR Busch Series event. In Mexico, you're watching NASCAR on Fox. Busch Series Racing on Fox, presented by America Online, is brought to you by UPS. We're going to race the truck. People love the truck. UPS, official delivery company of NASCAR, delivers the chance to win 4 tickets to next year's Daytona 500. Go to foxsports.com, keyword UPS. Welcome back to the Telcel Motorola Mexico 200 presented by Banamex. 49 of 80 laps complete, a bit of sunshine, a bit of dark clouds. And let's take you back to 1950. There's Bill France and Curtis Turner in front of an Oregon Cactus driving their Nash Ambassador in the 2,176-mile Carrera Panamericana. Herschel McGriff and Ray Elliott won in a 1950 Oldsmobile sponsored by the city of Portland, Oregon. Frank Mundy, whose real name was Francisco Menendez, was a competitor in these and 52 Grand National races. Marshall Teague also ran in Mexico. As there's Big Bill, the founder of NASCAR, with Curtis Turner hamming it up for the cameras. Fireball Roberts and Marvin Panch competed here in Mexico City in 1963 against this country's best drivers in an exhibition race. And now NASCAR, with its Busch Series, brings a point-paying race to Mexico, and we've got 11 or rather 49 laps complete.
All right, Elliott Sadler got the free pass. He'll have to be at the rear of the field, but he will have friends because Boris said and Jamie McMurray, Adrian Fernandez, they pitted too soon. When the caution came out, they will be at the back of the field with Elliott Sadler, and we have 35 cars on the lead lap.
41 car didn't come up to speed.
42 car.
42, I'm sorry.
Might have lost his lower gear as Darrell is running now, but
yeah,
didn't accelerate. Four in the lead, up front. Excuse me, that's bad. That's in front of the lead cars.
But Stan Barrett in the 36 cars, whereas Brent Sherman in the 58. Now that's the first and second place cars. Now we anticipate these cars will be making pit stop, but you know what? They're leading the race in Mexico.
So the Tucson Chevrolet of Stanton Barrett out in front of the 58 of Brent Sherman, who has some Grand Am road race experience.
It's pretty cool for Stanton Barrett to be leading the race here in Mexico.
Now the 11 of Paul Menard is laps down. Big shuffle right behind them.
Now Brent Sherman in the 58 and Stanton Barrett in the 36, they last pitted on lap 39, so they can go a while as far as their fuel. Now this is Tony Liberati, Borsett's crew chief, arguing that point that they did not pit too soon, but obviously NASCAR made the call. Right now Boris is back in 31st position.
What that inspector is trying to do, he's trying to explain that to him.
Part of the difficulty is the signal for pit road being open, that flag, or closed, is on the outside of turn number 8. The entrance to pit road is on the inside of turn number 8. A driver might not see that flag if he was concentrating on the commit cones entering pit road.
And you know, regardless of the circumstance right now, this, I mean, for Stanton Barrett, his owners, John and Nancy McGill, they really don't have a sponsor on the car for down here. No matter what the circumstances, this is a great run for them.
The 11 of Menard, the lap car giving room to Reed Sorensen.
What I like,
up to fourth.
What I like about road racing, Larry, everybody gets a chance. Play your pit strategy right, you might be the hero of the day.
Here's Matt.
Tony, pleaded your case to the NASCAR officials. What'd they tell you?
Well, Boris was in the third pit on pit road when the caution came out. He said, good call, we're good. And somehow or another they come up with it. I don't know. They need to prove it to me. And they did prove it to me. They took us out of this race. I think they are 100% wrong. Boris was in the third pit on pit road when that caution came out. And he said, good call. We was on pit road. Everything was good. Not only us, the 8 and the 41. Now, the 8 somehow made it, but the 41 didn't. I don't know how they did it. But they just took this yellow transportation car clean out of this race and made a call that I think was a judgment call, because I don't know if they got film or what, but afterwards, I want to see it. You know, I want them to prove to me that we was on pit road or not, because just saying, oh, I think they were, I don't believe that. And I know that they're trying to do all they can do, but we're trying to do all we can do, too, and, you know, I'm going to cost James money if I talk anymore.
It's a sport of emotions, and you can definitely hear the frustration in Rambo's voice.
Now, actually, Reed Sorensen in the 41 car, he was okay. It was his teammate, Jamie McMurray, in the 42, as well as Adrian Fernandez in the 5, that had the same penalty as Boris said in the 1.
Stanton Barrett under pressure from the Busch Series champion, Mayetta, New Jersey's Martin Truex Jr.
I got to believe old Truex. I mean, Larry, he's been at the front ever since the drop of the green flag. That corner stayed really, really good for him all day.
Whoa, big trouble. Denny Hamlin's off, and Fellows just backed it into the wall.
Ron's around again. I don't think I've ever seen Ron Fellows in this much trouble.
That one's going to hurt, Darrell. Not Ron, necessarily, but the car.
We're still under green, but I would have to believe he don't look like he's going to get that car going. We've not seen the caution flag just yet. Now, he gets it rolling now, so we may stay green here with 28 laps to go. We see Martin Truex Jr. in 8 car putting heat on Stanton Barrett in 36. But once again, I want to stress what a great run this is for this young Stanton Barrett. Did some road racing at Road Atlanta, and he's backing it up that, hey, I learned a little bit down there.
Yeah, because, I mean, he's not rolling over and they say, oh, it's Martin Truex, the Busch Series champion behind me. I better get out of his way. He's putting up a good fight.
Oh, Ricky Pearson, his crew chief, son of David.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Ricky.
Out of turn 8 to the front straightaway. Truex looking to the inside for the lead.
Truex got a great run off of turn 8 that time.
And Martin Truex will lead this race for the third time today.
That's the car to beat. The 8 car, definitely, with their pit strategy. I think that's the car to beat.
And as much as I question those guys coming to pit road back on lap 9,
Kevin Mannion, his crew chief, knew with enough cautions they could get to a window to make it a one more stop, so he has made this a two-stop race. What he wants now is no mistakes, stay on the racetrack, and he does not want to see a caution flag.
There
like
it is.
We just have right now.
Caution's out. 53 of 80 laps complete, caution flag waving. There is debris, perhaps from this, Chris Cook's car, which has lost the left front.
What usually happens on a road course is as it gets down near the end of the race in this kind of heavy traffic with these restarts after cautions, we're going to have a lot more cautions.
It was Cook's left front that sent Ron Fellows around and into the wall. Cook has made it back to pit road.
He's just easing through. He gets hit.
Darrell Cook turned left to avoid the stopped car of Denny Hamlin. He turned left straight into Fellows. Tough break for both those drivers.
And Ron, an 87 car, I think all week long, everybody figured him as being one of the favorites coming here. He won the very last road course race the Busch Series ran back at Watkins Glen in 2001.
Kind of battered that old girl up today.
Well, might run better. You never know.
Got that rear blade jacked up in there. Give me some tars.
Now this caution, it will be pretty good news, I think, for Stanton Barrett, the 36, running second, as well as Brent Sherman in the 58. Remember, I talked about them pitting on 39 with 41 laps to go. They could use a few caution laps to help that fuel mileage, and these guys could maybe salvage top 10, maybe even a top 5 finish today.
Sure looking good. The car's running great. He just didn't end up there. He did end up there by pit strategy, but he's able to stay up there.
Now, you look at all these pit crews, their jobs are pretty much over with. You know, the only reason that they still have tires out there for these teams now that we have 26 laps to go is in case you have a problem or you have a flat. There will be no more pit stops by the top cars.
One thing we don't see, Larry, are the rain tires that Goodyear brought here and were ready to mount up in case it was raining this morning. We have had a few raindrops, but we've now passed the halfway point in this race, so the treaded rain tires, along with the windshield wipers and the, in case of rain, tail light that would be used in case of inclement weather. We're not going to have a chance to test those under race conditions, it appears. And there's a couple of them back in the Goodyear compound.
It's something we only have at the road courses. And in fact, you talked about the Japan races back in 1997. We didn't have to race on them, but we had to practice and qualify on them at Suzuka. Drivers were pretty impressed with it.
Martin Truex Jr., your leader, were under caution. Busch Series Racing on Fox is presented by America Online. Want a better internet? You belong at America Online. And brought to you by Pizza Hut, home of the new Pepperoni Trio Pizza. Gather around the good stuff. By the U.S. Navy. Navy, accelerate your life. And by Aaron's. Aaron's makes dreams come true with dream prices on dream products. Welcome back to Mexico City. Brent Sherman, Denny Hamlin, and others making pit stops. Among NASCAR's tools are videotape replays that have what we call time code embedded in the bottom of the videotape, and that shows the exact time of day so that different video camera images can be synced up to gain a true overall picture of what happens on the racetrack. Let's show you the view from turn number 8 as Kevin Harvick takes the lead from Martin Truex Jr. Harvick's going to stay out to lead a lap. Truex is headed for pit road. So there's Harvick's 21 going by to take the lead. Here is Truex coming to the commit line right there to make his pit stop. Now, this will stop when the time code indicates that the moment of caution has occurred. We'll stop this tape and freeze it for you at the moment of caution. There's Reed Sorensen there. This tape has been synced up with the caution flag. No one is past the commit line at the moment of caution. The yellow flag is now waving at start-finish. Here comes Adrian Fernandez, Boris Said, and then Jamie McMurray come onto pit road after the moment of caution.
From the driver's perspective, he cannot, so once he gets to that point, he can't see that flag outside of turn 8 over there. So as far as he can tell, he's clear. When he, once he got on pit road, he did, he's past that point, so he can't see it. So he would say, good call.
Now what NASCAR did and what we did not do for you on the screen was sync up the moment of caution as it was determined from their timing and scoring computer. They punch a button, that lights the caution lights, that freezes the field, and it stamps a time code. They synced it up with that image to determine conclusively who was legal coming onto pit road and who would get a penalty.
Hey, what I'm pretty impressed with, those Boris said, we talked about it back in 31st, he's on a mission. He's already up to 15th position. Now, Fernandez in the five cars back in 28th, and McMurray in the 42 car, he's back in 24th, but Boris has really been on the run.
That call is our version of an instant replay. All right, that's basically what they do when they go over and look in the when a coach throws a red flag out.
So Martin Truex Jr. is our leader from Stanton Barrett, Reed Sorensen, Carl Edwards in the 60, Rusty Wallace is up there in the 64, the 32 of Shane Meal, for a fellow who's never been on a road course, he's had a great day. The 22 of Kenny Wallace makes an appearance at the top 10, along with Kevin Harvick coming back off that stop. And the 40 of Carlos Contreras, he's been a top 10 contender all day. And the 12 of Tim Fedewa.
And of all those top 10 or 12 cars, the only one we're not sure about their pitting strategy would be Stanton Barrett, Ricky Pearson in the 36 car, because he pitted on lap 39. He's trying to stretch, if he's indeed going to do it without a stop, 41 laps. But these cautions are helping, and we're not going to go this time, so that's another caution for Stanton Barrett.
Another lap under yellow as the free pass car gets waved around. There is Tony Liberati still upset over the call on his driver. Boris said, but as we have shown, it was the right call. The moment of caution had occurred well before Boris said hit the commit line to come onto the pit lane, as well as Adrian Fernandez and Jamie McMurray. Ruben Garcia Novoa, whom we last saw in the tire wall, had made repairs, and he is the free pass car on this caution, so he's being waved around. And we'll go one more lap before we go back to green.
So that'll give us 34 cars on the lead lap, and we have over 20 laps to go.
Yeah, and on a restart on a road course, it's all single file. So you're back there 15th, 20th, 25th place. You got your work cut out before you get to the top 10.
You bet. Next weekend, we move to Las Vegas, and our coverage begins on Friday. Nextel Cup qualifying and Busch Series qualifying, both on speed, beginning 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Then on Saturday, final practice for the Nextel Cup cars and the Busch Series race presented by TGIF, both on FX. Sunday, get your motor running with NASCAR This Morning on speed. The Nextel Cup race is on Fox, 2 p.m. Eastern, and NASCAR Victory Lane at speed to carry you home.
You know what, guys, with the new aero package, the new tire package, based on what we saw at Fontana, I can't wait, because I know we're going to have good side-by-side racing.
All next weekend across the Fox networks, NASCAR on speed, FX, and Fox. Let's update the hometown heroes. Carlos Contreras, top 10 all day. Jorge Guedes led the first 24 laps, had a spin, and he's climbing back to 13th. Jimmy Morales, 17th. Adrian Fernandez, after that penalty, is 28th. Jose Luis Ramirez is 29th. Novoa just got the free pass. Mara Reyes scored in 39th position, 5 laps back. Michelle Jourdain back on track, 11 laps down. And Rafael Martinez out of the race.
No 66 is clawing his way back in here. He's had a tough day, but he's working his way back.
Got inside of Tyler Walker there. They got together. Round he went.
You're right, DW. I mean, we know he has a good race car, but based on those first 25 laps, if he can get him a few cautions, pass him a few cars, get caught back up, he's not out of this picture at all.
Done a great job. Too bad that everything went south on him on that pit stop. He's been in trouble ever since, but he's slowly getting himself back in the game. I guess down here it went way south.
Or north. We're about as south as you can get for NASCAR.
I guess down here it goes north on you then.
We're coming to the green to complete lap 57. 23 to go. Pit stops pretty much finished up for the front runners. So it'll be Truex Barrett in the drive of his career. He's led this race for four laps and runs in second. Reed Sorensen, this amazing rookie who may well leave here with the Busch Series point lead. Stanton Barrett, Carl Edwards, what a series of obstacles he's overcome to now run in the fourth place. And Rusty Wallace, kind of quietly right there. There's Rusty kind of juking on the steering wheel.
That's him.
Yep.
Old Juki.
He's climbed his way to fifth.
And I think what has put him in the picture is Blake Bainbridge hitting him a little early when they got to that window where they knew they could make it. He caught the caution, and there he is up there in the top five. And the sun's popped back out. We're good to go.
Shane Meal is sixth. Kenny Wallace is seventh. Kevin Harvick is eighth. Carlos Contreras is ninth. Tim Fedewa rounds out the top ten.
I like the way this is shaping up. It's going to be a good finish.
23 to go, and they come by us.
Watch that left side. Don't pass.
Green flag. Shane Meal's got a run on Rusty.
He's working on him.
Nope, single file.
Everybody's done an incredible job of getting through that chicane today. Surprised the heck out of me.
We thought we were going to have all types of problems there. You see Reed Sorensen in the 41 car lock those brakes up, getting off into turn one. These guys know the best time you can take advantage of someone is on these restarts.
Down the recta trasera, the back straight, heading for turn four. Jeff.
Well, Mike, right now we talk about Reed Sorensen and the possibility of taking a point lead away from here. Well, just before we went back to green, Brian Patty, his crew chief, told him, be smart. Don't push the issue right now. You've done a great job to this point. And he reminded all four of the spotters who are working with him today around the racetrack to help keep him calm over these final laps. Matt?
Jeff, Carl Edwards' spotter, tells him there's a certain spot on the racetrack, and every time by, Carl hears the same thing. Brake early. Spotter's helping a lot of different teams here. I know that Martin Truex Jr. has two. The 11 of Menard had three starting the weekend, and they were looking for more. But the rookie battle between Edwards and Sorensen is really heating up. These two having very impressive runs. And one thing we haven't talked about, the possibility of a green-white checkered finish. And if that happens, the 60 is questionable. They will have enough fuel.
Yeah, man, I don't think you're not only going to have a rookie battle between those two guys, they possibly could be in the championship battle all year long.
Yeah, because Kevin Harvick is not going to run all the Busch Series races, so you would leave here with two rookies leading last year's champion. Boy, Shane Meal tried it again going into turn number one to the inside.
Just to update you on Robbie Gordon, you see him right there in the 83 car. He had got back to one lap down. He had made two of his laps up with the free pass, but finally I think that motor has expired.
The thing I would worry about, he has got a stream of...
Whoa! Reed Sorensen got up against the back bumper of Stanton Barrett. And Sorensen spins.
And with this many cars bunched together after restart, he was running third. He's going to be lucky to come back into place before the 30th place car goes by.
He's going to be lucky if he doesn't get run over.
Looks like the whole field's going to go by. This is going to be a big hit from him, and caution is on the racetrack. It's not for this, though.
It's got to be for Robbie Gordon. He put a stream of oil, about a foot wide all the way from turn eight in.
Now, you'll see blue flags all over turn seven and eight. Wow. That's the whole sump and then some.
Yeah, you can see down pit lane here where he came in. It's a big streak.
But the people that this caution benefits, you heard Matt Yoakum just talking about the 60 car, Carl Edwards, a little close on fuel. These cautions help buy a little extra mileage.
Earlier damage on Cook's car there, Chris Cook.
Road racing is it's really kind of interesting the way it all plays out. You never know who's going to end up in front at the end of the day.
See Robbie Gordon getting on the pit road there. A lot of liquid. See all the fluid behind him. That's the reason we're under caution here with about 21 laps to go.
Yeah, he got it off pit road as quickly as he could, as quickly as there was an opening, but the damage was done.
Like David Green, the 27 car had been in the garage for repairs. He's back out there 17 laps down now.
Let's show you again what happened to Reed Sorensen, racing for second place.
He's got a nose under Barrett. He thinks he does anyway, but then he realizes he's going to run into back of him, locks him up, spins it around. And now, I mean, he can't pull out.
Now this looks like an intersection in Mexico City.
And
you know,
this is,
if you get a gap, you'll go, but there's no gap.
There was
and
no
this
gap.
Is just after your crew chief said, be smart, you're doing a great job, don't make any mistakes.
Big picture. He's actually back in 34th position now, the last car that's on the lead lap.
Sorensen may, he probably flat spotted tires, he would likely pit and has nothing to lose
no,
until it's
come,
out.
Come get you four and wear it out now. Go ahead and use it on up.
Say the guy that does not like seeing these caution flags is our leader, Martin Truex Jr., because every time he gets a little bit of a lead stretched out, we have a caution, bunches them all back up again.
So Stanton Barrett is second. Our new third-place driver is Carl Edwards. Shane Beal is fourth. Rusty is fifth. To go in Mexico City in NASCAR's first ever points race south of the border. First ever points race in a national touring series outside the United States in the 50 plus year history of NASCAR. Reed Sorensen will make a pit stop to change those flat spotted tires. Jeff's there.
Yeah, Rodney McGee let him out right there. Seth Jenkins is changing those tires. Brian Patty said, guys, we got nothing to lose. If we're going to gain any ground from way back there, we're going to have four fresh tires and just a little bit of a tweak on the adjustment. But the rookie's been doing great all day long. They're hoping they can finish it off in grand style after getting caught up in a little bit of a miscue.
Thanks, Jeff. This circuit is named for two of Mexico's greatest auto racing stars, Pedro and Ricardo Rodriguez. Though 2 years younger, it was Ricardo who was first into Formula One, driving a factory Ferrari. You'll see his year-old number 8. Starting from the pole in the Italian Grand Prix at Monza in 1961, Ricardo was only 19 years old. But his career would be short-lived right here on this circuit at Turn 8. In 1962, he crashed to his death in practice. Pedro won 2 Formula One races, 67 in South Africa and 1970 at Spa in Belgium, and twice won the Daytona 24-hour race. He won 2 World Sports Car Championships for Porsche in the famed 917, and then he died in an inter-series race at the Nürburgring in Germany in 1971. And for the Rodriguez brothers, this circuit is named. And other Mexican racing stars have portions of the circuit named for them. Moises Solana, a Formula One driver, his name is carried on the Turn 1, 2, and 3 complex. And Hector Rabaque, the first Mexican driver to win in kart. The Turns 4, 5 complex is named for him.
And it's a beautiful facility. You saw right there, there's actually a baseball stadium in the middle of the infield. And the biggest thing I want to say there, you see it right there, the top of the grandstand, the people have treated us great since we got here on Thursday and Friday.
20 laps to go, Darrell. Martin Truex Jr., Stanton Barrett in the best drive of his career, Carl Edwards, and the road race ringers well back as we come into the closing stages of this one.
Yeah, I mean, we got a interesting cast of characters at the front here, but can they stay? Late in the race, as you saw Reed Sorensen, easy to make a mistake, fall back to 30th place.
Shane Meehl in the 32, who has never run a road race, in fourth place. Rusty Wallace, one of Nextel Cup Racing's all-time best on the road circuits, in fifth. In sixth, Kevin Harvick, who can get the job done turning right and left. But in seventh, the 22 of Kenny Wallace. And in eighth, first of the Mexican drivers, Carlos Contreras. Tim Fedewa ninth. Clint Boyer now up to 10th. And our pole sitter, Jorge Guedes, has recovered up to 11th place, just ahead of Ashton Lewis Jr. Boris Said in the one is 13th. The 28 of Johnny Sauter. And the 33 of Ron Hornaday Jr.
Well, you got, you know, Boris was last on that last car on the lead lap on that last restart. Here he is in 13th place. He's been making some moves. Look at, matter of fact, you can see what he's been using to make them.
There is a lot of speedy dry at turn 8 toward the pit entrance, where something let go on the number 83 of Robbie Gordon. So they're going to have to do a little bit more remedial work to make sure all of that fluid and speedy dry is swept up. So we'll take a break from Mexico. You're watching NASCAR on Fox. Welcome back to Busch Series Racing on Fox, presented by America Online. From the Autodromo Hermanos Rodriguez, the Telcel Motorola Mexico 200, presented by Banamex. And one of the pre-race favorites has fallen by the wayside, Matt.
Mike Cady, Ron Fellows here in the Chance 2 pit. Now, you're not working on a ride for Sears Point, are you? Because I can talk to Bono about that and help us along.
Well, you do that, please, Matt. Yeah, we're just, I gave Martin a little love tap earlier in the race. I just was, we're chatting about it and talking about the future a little bit, yeah.
So are we getting closer to possibly Bono getting you a first ever Nextel Cup Series win?
What do you think, buddy?
Yeah, we'll see. Disappointing day for you, though. You had a lot of high hopes coming in here.
Well, you know, and I know Joe's watching at home, and sorry, Joe. Car was really good. We got messed up in track position, and then the 60 car or 40 car, whatever. He kept messing up turn one, and I finally got underneath him because he was blocking, and I thought I gave him plenty of room going around the outside of him for turn two, and he spun me hard. So that was. Maybe I could have been a little bit more patient, but Joe, I think I owe you one.
Well, we will for sure see Ron at the Glen. He hopes we'll see him at Sears Point as well.
Joe is Joe Nemechek, Nextel Cup driver who owns this car that Fellows piloted today. There he is alongside Rusty Wallace. Takes it to the grass to avoid a collision. Then this, with the 40 car, as Ron just described.
I think what he doesn't know is a 40 car hit the curb and then jumped into it, which was pretty tight going right there, trying to go outside.
Then the big one when Chris Cook slammed into Fellows, both trying to avoid Denny Hamlin's spun car. That was the one that put Fellows behind the wall. Here's Jeff.
Well, Mike, down here in the 60 pit of Carl Edwards, talking to his crew chief, Brad Parrott, and I ask him, hey, can you guys turn it up a little bit and go after this win? He said, well, a lot of that's going to depend on Carl Edwards. But I've been telling them this all day long, Jeff, and it's worked pretty good. Brake early and patience. Now, that's two things right there a lot of times the driver doesn't always understand. But today so far, Carl Edwards has been paying attention to what his crew chief's been saying. They've got themselves in a pretty good position here with us a few laps to go.
You notice, Jeff, they just added that patience part on there.
That was a late addition.
That's right.
But Darrell, how many times have you told us you have got to drive slow to be fast
that's
on
right.
a track like this?
That's the one thing I learned on the road course is slow down and go faster. Brake early, get your car stopped. Before you get to the turn, get off the brake and then accelerate hard. There's such a, you can teach someone to road race. There's a technique to road racing, and that's part of it.
Carl Edwards, in that number 60, has had an interesting, an exciting, not a happy weekend so far. Friday practice, off course. Saved it. Trying to avoid Kim Crosby at the chicane. Destroyed it. Climbed into the backup car. Exploded it. And then came back to qualify in the top 10 on his time trial run.
And I think the biggest thing with 17, 18 laps to go, and I tell you, there's the crew's the one that I think did the biggest job this weekend. With only 17, 18 laps to go, and his closest competition right now, as we already talked about a little earlier, Reed Sorensen, he's back in 33rd. Good old top five finish would be pretty good here.
Patience. Better put that at the top of the list.
And there's the unsung heroes of the 60 team.
Brad Parrott is watching the big screens, sees himself on camera, gives the folks a wave. Hey, Brad. But right ahead of Carl Edwards is the man I think's had the drive of the day. Stanton Barrett's best ever finish in the NASCAR Busch Series. Fifth at Atlanta a long time ago, 1996. And, you know, he's in a position where he could win.
Well, yeah, he is in a position where he can win, but what I'm impressed with, I thought he would get run over or get passed by a lot of these fast cars. He has maintained. He's held that position, and he's up there for a great finish.
I mean, it might take a mistake on Martin Truex's part, because he's in a position to pounce if things come his way.
Well, he's got eight chances, Martin Truex does, to make a mistake every lap.
Well, okay. I think the biggest thing with Stanton Barrett in the 36 car, let's go back. He pitted on lap 39 with 41 laps to go. That's quite a bit further than we thought anybody could run. But we have all these cautions, and you know what? This team, they have nothing to lose. If they can sit here and have a top five finish today, that would be like a win. I talked to his owner the other day, John McGill. He said, you know what? We're here to try to be competitive, but we want to have fun.
Martin Truex's crew, they think, they hope their day is done on pit road at least. They'd like to follow that car into victory lane if they can. The other driver has had a great ride, that 32. It says Wynn on the hood for Wynn Fuel for Shane Meal. But this young driver has never run a road course race. And just to keep the fenders on that car in his first ever road course race, let alone run in fourth place, that's pretty impressive. We're coming for a restart. Green flag. 63 complete, 17 to go.
Mark Truex Jr. main car got a great restart over Stanton Barrett for 36 that time. He wants to stretch it out as far as he can early on this restart.
You never count old Russell out either. He's looming and lurking back there. Got that cup experience. Boy, Stanton's having a hard time on this restart. There's Rusty, and he's in the top five. And just right here at the end of the day.
Look who's coming. Harvick right behind him. Big slip and slide there.
Somebody's off. Man.
That was Fedor. Got right back on.
I tell you what, the car right behind Kevin Harvick, the 21, as he dived to the inside of Rusty Wallace.
And he dove.
He definitely dove.
That was a bold move.
But the car that seems to want to come with him, Rusty's brother, Kenny Wallace, in the 22 car. Didn't have that great of a qualifying run, 35th. He's up there in seventh spot in that 22 car.
The pole sitter's coming back. Jorge Getters in the 66.
I don't like the looks of that. That's coming out of the tailpipes.
That is not a good sign here with 17 laps to go. And that moves him up to the top 10.
Matt's in his pit.
My conversation underneath that caution flag, there was some conversation back and forth between the car and the pit about possible engine problems. You can see the telltale sign, the smoke for our pole sitter, Jorge Getters. The oil temperature continues to climb.
Yeah, it's not possible. I think it's definitely happening right now as we see Carl Edwards in the 60 car. He goes into second place by Stanton Barrett in the 36.
Challenge for third. Shane Meal goes to third in the 32. I'm corrected. He has run a road course race. He was 9 years old. It was in a go-kart.
Quite a while ago.
Getters just in front of that yellow freight car. Boris said, Getters in 10. Continues.
It does, but that's under, when the thing is decelerating, it's sucking oil up into the cylinder.
And who's off?
Is that Fedewa? Fedewa in the 12th car. And he was up there running in the 12th position. And he's going to lose all the way back to about 35th, which is the number of cars we have on the lead lap. Does not look like he can get that car going again.
It's going to be another caution if he doesn't. Definitely looks like he's cranking.
Tim overcame a lot of problems. Remember, he had to start at the rear of the field because of a transmission change, and he gets it going, but he's going to be way behind, but he'll still be on the lead lap.
Well, that's the crew chief telling him, waiting for the cars to go. 66 just
blew it up, didn't he?
Yeah.
4A Getters, our pole sitter. That's a big time explosion.
Does he know it?
Caution is out because of this engine right here. What a great run this race team
uh-oh.
Had today.
Uh-oh.
He knows it now.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I think NASCAR, I'm getting a report they're telling him to get off the racetrack because he's going to oil the entire track down.
He'd probably like to get off the racetrack, but he'd like to do it under control.
Well, the hope would be that all of that smoke is burnt up oil, that it's burnt up and not dripping onto the racetrack, but that's not likely, is it?
Let's see if we can see here. Pretty serious, I might add.
It doesn't have 15 laps left in it, that's for sure.
No.
Turn four.
We are seeing a little stream of oil right there because he blew up coming down the front stretch, so he's going to have to go all the way around this 2.5 mile racetrack to make it back to the garage. Just at the start-finish line.
Initially, I thought that smoke would just be maybe when he was downshifting, it was sucking a little oil up in the cylinder, but she sucked a little bit more than that up in the cylinder now.
Actually, Darrell, I'm surprised if that oil got on his tires, he was able to get through turn one without spinning that car out.
Finally got off the racetrack over on the back side. There you see the safety workers.
You see the oil on the hood over there on the left side, so it was putting down quite a bit of fluid.
15 laps to go. The pole sitter, Jorge Getters, who drove from the pole to a second place finish behind his brother in yesterday's Corona Challenge.
Now this is helping. It's helping a couple of guys. It's going to help Boyce Said lose him up a little bit, gets caught back up, and the 41 car of Sorensen. He's up to 25th with fresh tires.
Let me tell you who really likes it. This team right here, Brad Parrott, the 60 team with Carl Edwards, because now he's second behind Martin Truex Jr. Gets him caught up to that lead.
That's an interesting headset. We see that a lot of cup that Brad Parrott has, where he has actually a mouth cup so that he can talk to his driver without a lot of ambient car noise coming into his microphone.
I mean, this pit road is very, very close to the front stretch. When all 43 of those cars are on the front stretch at the start of the race or after a restart, you can't even hardly hear yourself think.
Maybe he's had some drivers say, I can't hear you.
Selective hearing.
Let's see if we can hear Matt.
Mike, that radio setup actually debuted at Bristol about 4 years ago. Retired Marine Major Pat Frossard, who used to work the flight line, came up with that idea, transferred that from the military to a racing type setup, knowing how difficult it is for drivers nowadays to hear the crew chiefs because of the noise level. And it really has helped out, and you can see it when we go to Bristol in about 4 or 5 weeks. You're going to see probably the majority of the crew chiefs up and down pit road using that type of radio setup.
That'll be key there also. That RE setup that Brad has also has noise canceling headphones, kind of like a lot of us wear on the airplanes. So that communication between driver and pit crew, which is so critical, can be understood easily.
You know, we watched our highlights a while ago as we see Tim Fedewa on pit road for repairs for tires. But Carl Edwards in the 60 car, we saw in the highlight film, that was a hard lick he took. He was sort of relieved that with all the practice on Friday, all he had to do yesterday was make one qualifying lap. And talked to him last night. We were over at the Ambassador's home for a little get-together. And, you know, he was feeling a lot better 24 hours after that crash.
Tim Fedewa is able to continue after bringing out this caution flag. 14 laps to go.
Hey, another guy's had a pretty good run today, Larry, is Ashton Lewis in the 25 car. He's hung around the top. Well, he's 11th now, and he's hung around there pretty much all day long.
Fox, tomorrow, the competition kicks into high gear as your favorite finalists compete live. You vote, you decide. Don't miss an all-new American Idol live tomorrow night at 8, 7 Central Time, only on Fox.
And our local fans here have still got a guy in the hunt. Carlos is up there in seventh. He's been there all day.
All day long.
It's a great run for Carlos.
66 of 80 laps complete. Martin Truex Jr. leading for the third time today. He's led 31 laps, the most of any driver, as we work the seventh caution flag.
It's not a lot of cars out of a race at a road course with this few laps to go. Attrition somewhat low here.
The rollback will take Getter's car off. He led 24 laps from the pole before making his first pit stop. Another driver we've not spoken much of, Jimmy Morales, had a little problems early in the race, driving the 52 that was qualified by Scott Gaylord, but he's up having a top 20 run.
Good for
number 52.
Jimmy Means. Jimmy Smut Means from Huntsville, Alabama.
Working on that car.
Where is he from?
Huntsville,
yeah.
Just up the road from Birmingham.
Former track champion at the Nashville Fairgrounds.
Yes, sir.
Jimmy come home with a top 15 finish, I'm sure they'd be very pleased.
Let's go back to pit road and Jeff Hammond.
Guys, I was down here in the pit area with James Finch, who's the owner of the one car that Boris Said drives, as well as the 28 car that Johnny Sauter is in today. And, you know, he said, all things considered, Jeff, I think we're having a pretty good day. I think Boris can get a few more positions. And if Johnny can stay right where he is, again, big picture racing, he gets a chance to score some valuable driver points. And that's what part of this stuff is all about, is to try to continue to look at the big picture. And that's one of the reasons why they put Boris in the one car and Johnny in the 28. He can get some seat time, kind of like driver car owner things. They're really trying to do a lot of big picture racing down here with this yellow freight team.
Well, I'd say considering about less than 20 laps ago, he was back in 33rd, 34th position. He's knocking on door. Well, he's in the top 10 now. I'd say that's a pretty good recovery.
The local hero, as pointed out early in the broadcast, the Dale Earnhardt Jr. of Mexico. There is Adrian Fernandez in the Lowe's number five, after having to serve that penalty for pitting too early along with Boris Said and Jamie McMurray. He's fought his way back into the top 20. Came in here as the overwhelming pre-race favorite, but crashed in qualifying and had to start based on the car owner points at the back of the field.
Hadn't been for that little miscue coming on pit road, I think he had a car that could win this race.
You guys talk about the popularity, Daryl, you and I were talking this morning. Over 105 million people in Mexico a couple of years ago. When you consider all the sports down here, baseball, soccer, Adrian Fernandez was awarded the Athlete of the Year in Mexico.
Thirteen laps to go in the inaugural Telcel Motorola Mexico 200 presented by Banamex. Now, Fernandez, known as an open-wheel driver, he's had success in kart and in the Indy Racing League, where he raced until the end of last season. Unexpectedly lost his sponsor at the end of last year. So while the IRL IndyCars are in Homestead Miami Speedway in Florida today, his drivers, led by Scott Sharp, driving cars he owns. But he's here driving in this Busch Series race. And one of his fans wearing his colors.
But just to update, you own Adrian Fernandez in the 5 car. Jeff Hammond was talking about Boris Said in the 1, as well as Jamie McMurray in the 42. Those three guys probably had cars that were in contention to win this race, but we had a caution come out about 20 laps ago, and those guys did not make it to pit road when pit road was still open. It was closed. They received a penalty. They had to go to the rear of the field, and they are trying their best to fight their way back. These cautions are not helping them.
13 laps to go. New Jersey's Martin Truex Jr., the reigning champion, trying to win NASCAR's first ever Busch Series race in Mexico. This is the Sun Pyramid, the larger of two pyramids close by Mexico City. There is a sacrificial temple there in the background where maybe some of these teams will bring some sheet metal after this weekend's over. And that is not Daryl out practicing in the pace car. That's a dust devil, just a little mini twister. The wind whips up from time to time.
That was cool, wasn't it?
Not if you're standing right next to it.
Those guys are getting away.
And now we're set to go for the final 11 laps. Truex, Carl Edwards, first and second. Shane Meal in third. Here's where the Mexican drivers are running. Carlos Contreras, who has been top 10 all day. In that number four, he leads them in seventh place.
Can you say shootout? Or no,
not in
maybe
Spanish.
Maybe it'll be spinout.
I learned all my Spanish from Dora the Explorer and Scott's kindergarten Spanish teacher, Julia Pollins.
I learned all mine from Jake.
The free pass car being moved around, I believe that's Paul Menard. Patricia Monterola, Mexican soap opera star, who waved the green flag this afternoon and has a lot of fans here.
She ought to be worn out. She's been doing that ever since the race started. Pretty sure she's saying undelay, undelay.
And we're set for what these drivers hope will be the final restart of the day.
Saw her standing up. I'm looking around at both grandstands on both sides of the front stretches. Right at 100,000 people, every one of them are standing on their feet.
Total weekend crowd estimate, 160,000, making this quite a successful venture for NASCAR. To Mexico, they've appointed Chad Little, who's going to lead NASCAR in Mexico and run a yearly racing series.
Yeah, I don't know that we've ever had over 100,000 people at a Busch Series race, possibly close at Bristol. But well, I tell you, it's 56,000 here yesterday just for qualifying. Car, Carl Edwards in the six, rubbing those tires back and forth, trying to keep them clean.
Clean them up, clean them up.
Don't want to spin those tires on this restart, DW.
That's right. Clean them up. Let's get ready to go here.
So here they come off turn eight onto the front straightaway. It'll be 11 laps to go. Green flag.
Carl Edwards in that 60. He was trying to stay right on that rear bumper, but Martin Truex Jr. in the eight gets another good restart.
Carl spun the tires. You see the smoke come off his tires? He spun his tires.
Contreras with a run on Rusty. Drops back in line.
Now the dust, of course, is the oil dry that was put down from Jorge Getter's engine letting go. Carl Edwards looks to the inside.
You gotta be careful right here because everybody's had trouble getting around this first turn.
Look at that battle back there from about 6th to 12th, though. That's quite a wad of cars.
Kenny Wallace, the 2. Clint Boyer trying to stay on the pavement and not make contact. And Morissette trying to make three wide. Morissette and that orange, yellow number one alongside Clint Boyer makes the pass.
He made it. Those guys set him up perfectly.
He is on a mission.
It's all that patience and all that other stuff, forget that. It's showtime, boys.
What they needed to do. His first road course race, they stayed on the racetrack, they've had good pit strategy, and they've kept their nose clean. Exactly what they wanted to do here today.
Whoa.
By the time I spoke, he almost got off the racetrack.
Now that could have been big. That's what happened to Fernandez qualifying. Popped her off right there.
Into turn seven, sliding through eight, and back to the front straightaway.
Ten to go. 10 laps can seem like eternity at a road course. See Kevin Harvick in the 21 putting pressure on Stanton Barrett in the 36. Remember, Stanton's on some very old tires, doing a good job just to hold on to it.
10 laps is only 80 more turns.
Oh, okay. And how many shifts? About 80 shifts.
Well, Harvick better look in his mirror. Carlos Contreras in the 40 is right there.
Carlos has done himself proud today. He's been in the top 10 all day long. Been very consistent. No, hot rod looks pretty good. Whoa.
Boris got inside of Kenny Wallace.
Look at Harvick putting the block on Contreras in the 40 car.
That was a truckload of cinder block he put on him as Shauna Robinson goes for a spin.
Don't you love it? Gets inside of 10 to go.
I think that's the problem. The drivers have been told 10 to go.
As we say back home, business is picking up.
Time to go.
two guys that aren't really all that worried about it don't look to me like the Truex and the Carl Edwards. They have just pretty well checked out.
We'll see these laps wind down. Nine to go next time by.
Boys back here. I mean, he is using up every inch of the racetrack.
Now here's Rusty coming after Contreras, Rusty Wallace.
Rusty has worked all day long trying to recover from that not-so-good qualifying run, but Darrell, you mentioned it earlier, one of the first cars out in qualifying. The track didn't have very much grip whatsoever.
Morissette under pressure from Bowyer.
I don't think I think Bowyer was hot.
Bowyer got him.
I think that the voice and Bowyer kind of had that little go at it there a little bit ago, and Boyer's determined to get him back.
Morris to the outside.
This is really not the place to...
Tap back in on him. Yeah, the outside in the one is not the hot ticket. These guys are battling for the eighth position right now.
Oh, Carlos slowing down.
Oh, that's a shame.
Man.
Carlos Contreras, veteran of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, on tap for maybe a top five finish, and now
somebody else up here is spinning out.
And that's Barrett. Stanton Barrett. Spins out of the top five.
Yeah, he was running fourth. He's going to fall back in place about 14th or 15th.
And it's two really feel-good stories, Dan Barrett and the Carlos Contreras up there, and they both have trouble in the closing laps.
So here's your new top five. Martin Truex, Carl Edwards, and Shane Neal. This should put Kevin Harvick up to fourth and Rusty Wallace to fifth. Johnny Sauter getting pressured by Tyler Walker in the 38, and McMurray.
McMurray in the 42, trying to get back in the top.
Whoa! Oh, front straightaway.
Bowyer
hangs on.
Somehow, somehow.
He's a dirt track racer. He just wanted to stir up a little dust.
Look at that rear bumper. I think someone stirred him into the dust.
He and Morris have been having a pretty good go at it. You see Boris's front and you see Bowyer's rear. I mean, you know, maybe there was something took place there. That's a great save down this front straightaway out in the grass like that.
See Stanton Barrett right there in the 36 car. Last lap he was running fourth. Now he came back across the line in 13th.
And losing spots.
Three wide. That's Fernandez trying to come up and get past the 35 of Jason Keller.
That's a battle for 15th.
Ooh, so Fernandez has gained five positions since the restart.
Well, he gained three and they gave him two.
Okay. Watch the two of Clint Bowyer. Here he comes. There he goes.
And I mean, that's all four of them off right there.
And he had no help. He was on his own.
Yeah.
By himself.
Only lost one spot.
That raised up a little twister.
Yeah.
Pretty exciting view from our cameraman there coming off turn eight.
What was that little dust thing we saw a little bit ago?
Dust devil. Meanwhile, 7 laps to go.
Boy, Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car, he is stretching it out almost 3 seconds over second place Carl Edwards in the 60. Martin's just saying, guys, please behave for 7 more laps. I do not want another caution.
Word from Jeff Hammond is that Carlos Contreras lost an engine within 10 laps of the finish with a top 5 in sight. It's still running, but it's down a couple cylinders. They're going to try to nurse him along to the finish.
Yeah, that's
here's the race from fifth on back.
And it's a good one back in here.
See Tyler Walker in the 38 car. He was running in the top five.
Whoa.
And then Ashton Lewis. Here comes McMurray on the outside.
Might make it stick.
Yeah.
It's not going to stick right there. The 8 wheels better than 4 did not work.
No.
They could be a lot more. They had a 33. He went underneath them all the way in the grass.
They're going to have a lot of company here with all that smoke.
Now, the blue flag will be waving, and that means there is trouble ahead, but you do not have to hold position. It's not like a yellow caution flag. It means be aware.
Yeah.
Be very aware.
I haven't seen many guys make an outside pass work.
Well, you get way outside there at turn 4 dirt, or it's hard to get back for turn 5.
Well, and it's all the rubber and dirt and everything out there, too. You just can't make it stick.
We car. He's way, way out there in turn four. Way out there. Here comes trouble.
Yep. He knew it.
You could see him lock those front
lights. He knew it.
Up. The law of physics was taking over.
Look at Hornaday in the 33.
Start stacking up behind him.
No caution flag for that one.
That caused
a lot of scattering.
Cost a lot of guys a few positions.
There's the blue flag you see waving middle of the screen. Blue flag, schmoo flag. Just get me through here, please.
McMurray's on pit.
Yeah, he's driving that car that Reed Sorensen is going to try to test at Phoenix. It's not looking too good now.
Horace said has passed Rusty Wallace for now fifth place.
And Boris said, unlike Martin Truex Jr. in the 8, our leader, he's saying, I wish you guys were misbehaving. Get me a caution flag and catch me back up. Give me one more shot. Remember, 25 laps ago after that penalty, Boris said was back in 32nd position. And that's with a lot of cautions that didn't help him.
This will make Tony Liberati feel a little bit better. He got back.
His crew chief.
Tony was not a happy camper.
Not at all.
I'm not sure he and Rusty are done with each other.
Well, Rusty's a lot faster on the straightaway. Boris is faster through the turn. So Rusty catches him, but he can't do anything once he gets there.
There's Edwards in second, going through the bottom of your frame. Harvick in third, Shane Meal in fourth. Here's the fifth place battle. Boris Sett in fifth, Rusty Wallace in sixth. They are now joined by Clint Bowyer in seventh and Kenny Wallace in yellow and orange in eighth.
We're hearing that Carlos Contreras has finally taken his car to the garage. Again, engine problems on that race car. And, Mike, you were talking about the top 10. The guy that I was watching, Adrian Fernandez, just went by him. But Johnny Sauter, driving for Jay Robinson Racing, Terry Allen, the crew chief, they've kept their nose clean today and been right up there in the top 10 or 15. Good run for them.
It's that black number 28. Adrian Fernandez has cracked the top 10, Darrell.
That's a great recovery as well. I mean, these guys have really done a great job in these closing laps.
Justin Labonte moving to the inside of Novoa in the 72 and completes the pass.
It's a battle for about 24th or 25th.
Well, Justin got caught up in that spin there a while ago with McMurray, and he had to take evasive action. He lost several spots. You might add that the 8 car just went by. And oh, by the way, there goes the 60.
Yeah, four seconds behind him.
I gotta believe old Russell was back in there running in the fifth, sixth spot. He'll be happy.
Tyler Walker gives up a spot to the seven of Chris Cook.
And that Chris Cook and that
seven. Oh, here we go. Here's the car off.
That's a seven car. I was just about to talk to him. I mean, he has been off the racetrack. He had to go to the rear of the field with the engine change. I mean, this guy has had quite an eventful day.
But now, Larry, we've been here. We've watched this whole race. We haven't seen any cars go off of that turn until 10 to go. And now we've seen a dozen go off.
Somebody just missed the chicane there. That was
Randy
LaJoy. Yeah.
In the 34 car. Kevin Harvick in that 21 car. He's closing in on Carl Edwards in the 60 car. We have about 3.5 laps to go. He's there.
What Harvick's been doing, his Busch team is awesome.
Harvick is one of those drivers. Doesn't it just seem that he just picks up a few tenths when somebody is within reach?
He's got that nature about him.
Just remember the 21 car. Now, Kevin Harvick will not run the whole season, but just like 2 years ago when they won the Owners' Championship, he will share this ride with Brandon Miller. They love to repeat, as the Owners' Champion. He is all over the back of Carl Edwards in that 60 car. Three to go.
He's there.
He has that right position.
Out breaks Carl Edwards.
And you know what Carl said? After the week I've had, the weekend I've had, you just go ahead, buddy.
Have at it.
Yeah. I'm not going to challenge you. Whoa.
Harvick got a little loose there off that corner.
So now it's Harvick who is a little more than 5 seconds behind Martin Truex. And Shane Meal now closing in on the 60. There's our leader. Lonely guy.
Yeah, look how far ahead he is.
I'm going to tell you what, I'm going to go back to our qualifying show yesterday. We interviewed John Wood. And Jeff Hammond or Matt Yoakum one asked him, said, what do you think about this place? He said, I'm lost more than Jed Clampett in Beverly Hills. And he has kept his nose clean, and he's sitting there running 14th. I guarantee you he would love to leave here with a top 15 finish. There you see him right there in the 47 Clorox car.
Looks like he will. Reed Sorensen right behind him, but nobody else too close.
Remember, Reed Sorensen, as we see the 43 car off the racetrack, that's Jose Luis Ramirez.
I think that's the third time for him today.
Sounds like he's going to get him fired up and get back on the racetrack, so we'll stay green.
NASCAR West competitor, as well as he's done a lot of racing here. Jeff, Adrian Fernandez back up into the top 10 after a long, tough day.
Mike up back up the top 10, and right now crew chief Jim Long has been encouraging. He's running everybody down about a second a lap. He's going to run out of laps, but what a great comeback after all the trouble he's had, crashing a car qualifying, getting sent to the back because he pitted too early. He has really done a yeoman's job as far as getting the job done all day long here in that five car, and he's going to have a really respectable finish.
I'd say he definitely will win the reward for passing the most cars in one race.
Open wheel star and Mexican racing legend running M10. Truex's lead now 5.7 seconds.
He just keeps adding on. I mean, he just keeps pulling away.
Two to go. Harvick safe in second, but Carl Edwards is going to have a mirror full of Shane Meal before this one's over.
Shane Meal in the 32 car. He's there. He'll have about a lap and a half to try to make it happen for third.
Looks like Carl's car's got just a little tail happy under power.
You know, they made some major adjustments on that car not too many laps ago. White flag this time.
Under bright sunshine, Martin Truex Jr. grabs the white flag. Here comes Harvick. Edwards is stretching it out over Shane Meal, third to fourth. Boris Said up to fifth, Rusty Wallace sixth. Clint Bowyer, 7th. Kenny Wallace, 8th. Ashton Lewis, 9th. Fernandez in 10th.
This will be a good points day for Martin Truex Jr. He came in here 8th in points, a couple of rough races, so this will maybe put him back on track. Remember, this is our current reigning Busch Series champion, Martin Truex Jr.
Good race for Morissette and for his teammate, so to speak, Johnny Sauter, who's 11th. Hornaday is 12th. Keller, 13th. Sorensen, 14th. John Wood at 15.
You know, all these young drivers, they talk about Boris, and he goes and tests with them and really helps them on the road courses. He's a good teacher. And then he goes out and shows them how to do it.
Still hopping those curves on the last lap, Kevin Harvick.
And Kevin Harvick has finished second in the first two Busch Series races. This would be three second-place finishes for him. Quite a way to start the season.
Off turn 6. Headed for 7 and 8 and the start-finish line and the checkered flag. Martin Truex Jr.'s last Busch Series win came at Memphis. He was 4th at Daytona and takes the checkered flag. Martin Truex Jr. wins the first NASCAR point race in Mexico. Kevin Harvick comes across 6.2 seconds behind.
Really have to hand it to this crew right here, Kevin Mannion. He made that call to pit this race car on lap 9. He felt like with enough cautions, he could get that track position and maintain and do it on one more stop.
Adrian Fernandez finishes in the top 10. And so doing, he is the highest Mexican driver to finish this race. Stacy Compton got spun there coming to the flag. He had been 25th. Let's see what happened here at turn 7.
Oops.
Justin Labonte in the 44 car.
Well, they're both lucky.
Justin got into the outside wall.
Labonte broke loose and collected Compton. We'll go to victory lane with Martin Truex Jr.'s 7th win in his 52nd Busch Series start. The big smoke show for the fans in Mexico City. Martin Truex Jr. lit up the hides half the length of the front straightaway.
Scorching them babies.
The crowd loved it too.
And through two gears.
Well, I'll tell you, that car has been, I mean, it was just bad fast all day long. Martin did a great job. I mean, kind of feel the same way he did. Who would have thought that? I never thought that he would run that. I knew he'd be good, but I didn't know he'd be that. They seem pretty confident this week.
Big roar from the crowd. Matt Yoakum's in victory lane.
And a big roar from the driver, the ninth different driver to win a NASCAR Busch Series race on a road course. This one means a lot, but you predicted it yesterday.
I didn't predict anything. I knew I had a strong car.
You said you're going to take that car to victory lane.
Well, I knew it was good. It was good on long runs. And, you know, we were kind of counted out. You know, there's a lot of guys that probably didn't think we could win it. And I talked to Dale Jr. last night on the phone. And he asked me if I could win. I said, my car's pretty good. And he said, just keep it on the road, man. You'll be all right. And that's what I did. It was awesome all day long. The best it was at the end all day. And just my hats off to these guys on this Bass Pro car. This thing was awesome all day long. It was just a blast to drive it.
And what was going through your mind when Bono started playing with the pit strategy, pitting early on lap 9?
Well, I was a little nervous. I said, you know, nobody's coming with us. And he said, don't worry about it. We're good to go. So, you know, that's his job. He knows exactly what he's doing most of the time. And he done an awesome job today. The car was great, flawless all day long.
What a versatile young man. He's won a restrictor plate race. He's run on a short track. Now he has won on a road course.
Well, let's have a look at the Mr. Clean Auto Drive. Clean finish. Here's the final pass to the lead. Adrian Fernandez up and over the bump in the chicane, upsetting his car and opening the door for Martin.
Adios from there. Amigos.
I don't think Truex has a mark on that car.
And so I don't think he raced anybody other than Adrian there.
Kept it clean and on the track all day. Kevin Harvick has his third straight runner-up finish, Jeff.
Mike, Kevin Harvick's got three straight second place finishes. Most people be smiling about that, but like you said, you needed one caution flag and one extra lap.
Yeah, we didn't need much. This Palom Pellerico Chevrolet was fast, and all we needed was three chances there. But shoulda, woulda, coulda. Just got to say thanks to Ricky and all these guys that did a great job all weekend. We stuck to our plan, and they caught the caution and got in before the yellow came out, and we had to wait one lap. But still a good day for us.
Mike, what a difference a one lap can make.
Well, Kevin Harvick has reason to smile. He will leave here with the Busch Series points lead as he had it coming in. Carl Edwards to second, Clint Boyer now third, and defending champ Martin Truex fourth ahead of rookie Reed Sorensen.
Yeah, Reed came back to finish 14th after that spin late in the race, had those fresh tires, and came from about 33rd to 14th in just a handful of laps.
And you know, it wasn't too long ago Harvick ran all the races, Busch and Cup. One of the best years he had. Maybe he ought to reconsider.
Great day for Carl Edwards third and for Shane Meehl finishing fourth, both series regulars. They'll all be in action next weekend in Las Vegas as our Fox cameras move out west with Speed Channel on Friday for Cup and Busch qualifying. Saturday we move to FX with Nextel Cup practice and the Busch Series race presented by TGIF. On Sunday, Speed Channel coverage morning and evening, bracketing the Nextel Cup race that you'll see on Fox beginning 2 p.m. Eastern Time. All NASCAR across the Fox networks next weekend from Las Vegas.
You know, we talked about it at the top of the show. You see Martin Truex Jr., Kevin Mannion, Chance 2 Motorsports. No one can ever take that claim away from them. They won the first race out of the country in the Busch Series.
Martin Truex Jr. is the man with all the pesos as we leave the Autodromo Hermanos Rodriguez.
But let's see, on delay this week, and next week, Viva Las Vegas.
You got it, baby.
I don't know about you fellas, but I think NASCAR is here to stay.
Say you're right.
A great day for Martin Truex Jr. and for the NASCAR Busch Series and one lucky dog.